Welcome back to the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games, one event in the books on the opening day of competition, and it's time for event number two, and perhaps the most outside-of-the-box event that is known thus far. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Amanda Krenz with you as we get ready for Cyclocross. And after the opening event, your points leader is the reigning two-time second fittest woman on earth, but she sits first after that opening event. Tia Claire Toomey with the win and 100 points. Christy Aramo, Sam Briggs, Jamie Green, and Tennille Reed-Burline round out the top five. And the next test is three lovely little laps around this 1.5 mile track.
And we're getting on the bike, 1.5 miles. It's a straight start, but then you hit these tight turns. You go over some barriers, and then you have some more turns, but that's an up and down hill. Hit the sand pit. Well, you hopefully don't hit the logs on the back half of that. But it was quite a rough practice session for a lot of these girls yesterday.
And this also in the time trials that set the field. Several accidents throughout the course, mostly on the logs and the barriers.
And the deal with these logs is that they're going too slow. They're intimidating when you're coming up to them, but you have to hit them. Well, not don't hit them. Go over them with some speed, as they'll take you off the side. But there was one of the most dangerous ones we saw yesterday. It was Chelsea Hughes, who went over the handlebars, landed on the back of her neck. But she got back on the bike and finished through, so she'll be in the seat.
So that's a look at the obstacles these athletes face. Let's take a look at the bike, and for that we go to Amanda Krenz.
The bikes these athletes are riding are Trek Excalibur 7s. They're 2017 models. They weigh 28.4 pounds. Now, there's a smaller frame size that a lot of the women are going to be using, and that's based off of the bike fitting they did. The tires are 2.2 inches wide. They have two different diameters, 27.5 inches for those smaller frames and 29 inches. Now, those smaller frames are going to be better for power and handling for a lot of the shorter athletes, which a lot of these women are.
Thank you, Amanda. And here in heat number one, it's not the top 20 qualifiers or the bottom 20. They kind of scattered them. The top qualifiers in this heat are athletes 6 through 15 in time trials yesterday, led by Mackenzie Riley, who was the sixth fastest qualifier at just over 7 minutes. Somebody to keep an eye on here on this page, though, Margot Alvarez, not the best qualifying moment, but she's shown proficiency on the bike in games events in the past.
She has in the past, but she wiped out yesterday too when she was going over the log, so I'll see if she can kind of keep it together and not let what happened yesterday affect what's going to go on today.
10 seconds.
For the first time since 2012, bikes are involved at the CrossFit Games, and it's cyclocross time going into turn number one, and this could be the most treacherous part aside from the obstacles with this group of 20 heading in at full speed.
Oh, what the obstacle is it's not just the hairpin turn sidewinding back and forth, but it's the number of athletes that are starting this particular race. Now, you know, qualifying yesterday, look at your start in the back. Now, the more dangerous part of this course yesterday was the rocks and the dirt. Now with all the rain that we've had this morning, it's actually the grass that's going to be the hardest part for a lot of these athletes, because that makes a grippy surface that was kind of grabbing athletes' tire yesterday into almost like this little slip and slide through these turns. And they got to be definitely careful when they start hitting the sidewinding up and downs on the hill portion of this.
Out in front, Jamie Green and Tia Claire Toomey. Green in gray, Toomey in the white leader jersey, as she is the points leader after the opening event. But perhaps the person making the biggest charge through the field in the white jersey just coming out of that turn is Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet. I saw her go by about four people in that opening turn.
Well, she didn't have the best qualifying run yesterday, and I think it was more of a lot of these athletes were just practicing the course, getting used to the turns, the obstacles that they're going to be facing three laps through, and it's also getting used to these gears. There's almost 27 gears on these bikes, and you got to know when to shift down, when to gear up, and that's hard to learn, you know, just cold turkey on a bike like this. Having the proficiency with knowing when to gear up and gear down on this is going to be a huge advantage for those that are used to a bike like this.
And we were seeing some times around that 7 minute mark in time trials yesterday. That pace is going to be slower with the three laps here, maybe looking at about an 8 minute or so pace.
You could see that, it's a tight time cap as well, but you know, you got to factor in, we had a lot of slow times on crashes. The worst crashes that we saw previous in this, all those athletes are in this heat. And I'd be curious to see is how that tempers some of their intensity when it goes through. Now, there's one thing that, you know, we didn't touch on when there was a big group is that, you know, this still is cycling to a certain extent, and drafting is a part of that. So when you kind of sit behind someone's tire or wheels, you're going to let them do the work for you and then maybe pass them on turns or obstacles as they're about to move into their first obstacle. And those are that four barriers that they're going to have to dismount the bike from and then get back on.
As the leaders Toomey and Green approach the barriers, and this is where control is going to be very important. Some quick dismounts there to see how they do on getting back onto the bike once they clear that final barrier.
And what you saw Toomey do is just kind of lift the bike up from that crossbeam at the bottom just below the tire where Green put it over her shoulder. I don't think that's really necessary. It's not a whole lot of time lost, but it is seconds here and there. And, you know, the barriers aren't that high. You don't need to put it over your shoulder and run through. And what you want to look for is that you're going through this is that, I was speaking earlier, knowing when to gear up, to shift up, shift down. When you're hitting your downhills or your straightaways, jack it up to a really high gear and you're going to get the most power out of it. You can see they're starting their climbs. That's when you want to shift down and let that revolution speed up a bit. And then you have situational awareness. When you're in a big group and you hit tight turns, you got to know where you are at the time with the people around you. And with these obstacles as well as that, you know, we had too many people slowing down before the logs that we'll see in the back half of this course. That is more dangerous than hitting them too fast. And again, you have to be comfortable. And if you're not, I would honestly just dismount the bike, get over it, and get back on the bike.
Leader continues to be Tia Claire Toomey, about halfway through the opening lap of three here in event number two. So the winner in the run, swim, run event trying to back it up and really complete what we could call this triathlon hat trick, if you will.
45, I got it.
And you see we have two sets of these. And he said, that's the speed you want. You know, you want to pop the tire a little bit, let the bike get over. You got to make sure you stay back on your pedals because if you pop the tire up and you lean forward, when your back tire hits those, that's what's going to vault you over your handlebars. So you have to sit more back on the bike.
Toomey opening up a pretty nice lead over Jamie Green, the game's rookie out of the Meridian Regional. But Toomey with a slip coming out of that turn, maybe hit one of those divots that are in the ground, and Green right back under her rear wheel.
And as we were saying, with the hard rain that we had, it wasn't very long, but it was enough to make everything wet, everything a little bit more dangerous. And what's here, too, is that you're coming downhill. You're gaining a lot more speed. And what you want to see is you want to swing out wide. That was pretty good for Toomey, Green as well, as you want to swing out wide and take the turn along the backside of this.
And we're actually seeing a couple of downhill portions on this hill as they work through this set of the switchbacks. This might be the only chance that they have to have a little bit of recovery time on the bike.
It is, and the downhills will. It's not very much recovery time. The athlete who tested this, who is a professional cyclocross athlete, he says this is actually a very tough course because traditional courses are a little bit longer per laps, and there's more opportunities like straightaways and downhills that they actually get a break. With this course design is that there is no time for breaks because even on this straightaway, it's slightly uphill. That's a problem. And we have the sand trap coming up. It's going to be a bit of a turn, a downhill slide. And what you want to see is I want you to see you shift down in gears, just like you would climb, get as far as you can into the sand, and then dismount. And what you see is Jamie Green on the side. It's just enough. It's a little bit to not have to run too much. You're letting the bike do the work for you, and you save yourself some speed. You don't have to pick the bike up. Just let it sit on the sand and mount it right off the top. So Tia Claire, she picked the bike up. I don't think you need that. Rest on the bike. It's easier to push something and run than it is to pick up something and run.
Tia Claire Toomey just cannot get out of battles for the lead here on the opening day of competition. She had it against Christy Aramo in event number one for the entire final mile and a half on the run. And here on the back half of this mile and a half lap to kick it off of three, she's now battling with Jamie Green for the lead.
And what they're coming up is the final obstacle on the course for the lap. It's another set of logs, different than the first set because it kind of pops up in the middle where the first set was more flat laid across. And this is where we saw the most wipeouts happen yesterday during practice. And you see off course there. And here's the deal. You got to learn how to pop a wheelie, and it doesn't take much. You want to stand on the pedals, and as soon as you reach, you're going to pull back on the front tire. you don't need to overpower it. Where we saw a lot of athletes screw up yesterday is that, you know, they're all big, strong, aggressive human beings. They're pulling so hard the bike would tilt in the air a little bit, and now you're coming down on the angle. That's where you see people wipe out. It's just a little pop and get that back tire over the back.
And the athlete that we saw with that trouble nearly hitting the barricade on the side of the track, it's Bethany Branham, who had that issue in time trials yesterday as well. So coming through lap number one at about 7 minutes and 40 seconds, it's Tia Claire Toomey in first, Jamie Green in second, Bethany Branham in third. So the two-time second fittest woman on earth is being chased down by two games rookies behind her.
And this is where the biggest advantage you can have for speed and in aggressiveness, because as soon as you get past that final log, you have an uphill turn, and then from there it's downhill and you have a long straightaway. The second lap, you know, that's kind of that middle round, if you're, we're talking just CrossFit events in general or workouts, is that this will be the toughest one from a strategy standpoint. Where do I push? Where do I back off? You got to understand is that there's a whole nother wave after this group being in the first grouping. But when I hit that back half and I've got some downhill, I'm going to gear up as high as I can, use the downhill to gain momentum and try to gain some distance on the rest of the field. Maybe not the person behind you, but you're going to have a lot of separation on that straightaway.
Top five after that opening lap. It's Toomey, Green, Branham, Mackenzie Riley, the top qualifier here in this heat, in fourth, Emily Abbott in fifth. So the five fastest qualifiers coming into this heat are the top five. Biggest mover in the top 10, Lauren Fisher, has moved from 11th place out of the order of athletes here in this heat up to seventh.
And one thing I'd like to see more, or I'm surprised I'm not seeing enough of, is people getting out of the seat. Get out of the saddle. You see Toomey right there on the turn. That's good. What you want to see is that you got to be careful in the turns, but as soon as you get out of the turn, that's the time to stand up, pedal down hard, and get around some of these athletes on these tight turns.
Somebody figured out the pacing here, and it's Bethany Branham, the game's rookie out of the South Regional, has moved past not only second place Jamie Green, but the leader Tia Toomey. So we have a new leader for really the first time throughout this race, and it's Bethany Branham out in front.
So you take the turn. This is when you get up out of the saddle. Pick up your speed until the next turn. See how she's still a little crouched? Look, stand up, get the arms straight. You can sway the bike side to side as long as you're not swinging with it. On the turns, and you hit these little straightaways. Get up out of the saddle and get through and try to gear up and get some distance on the athletes behind you.
10-minute mark in this 30-minute time cap event. They're working on lap number 2 of 3 on this 1.5-mile, 20-turn, 3-obstacle cyclocross course.
You see Branham, her drives, you can tell she's in a higher gear, a little bit slower cadence, Toomey and Green behind her. Not quite as high of a cadence, their feet are pedaling a little bit faster. As I said, on the straightaways, you gotta kick it up in gear and get the most bang for your buck when you have an opportunity to hit a straightaway or not over these obstacles.
Quick dismount, nice transition onto the carry portion of this, right back onto the bike. A little bit of a stumble getting onto the pedals, and that'll close the gap again a little bit. But neither Toomey nor Green were able to really capitalize with a smoother transition themselves.
Like Branham, out of the saddle, driving her legs. It gets a little bit uphill at this part. It is a straightaway, but at this point in time, the second part of the lap, they've been driving hard on the bikes for about 11 minutes. You know, the legs are definitely starting to burn because, you know, we forget is they already did a 5K run and 500-meter swim just about an hour ago. So their legs are going to be more tired, I think, than they thought coming into this event.
About 8 seconds, the interval coming out of the switchback.
There we go. That's what I want to see. Get up and pedal hard and get some distance. You have a perfect opportunity. The road is flat. Kick it up into a high gear. Get out of the saddle and sprint to the next turn.
Speaking of a quickened pace, Jamie Green with that pace now. She goes around on the outside of Tia Claire Toomey, moving into the second position. So the top three at the start of this lap, at the midway point of the lap now, has been inverted from that first point.
Then we reach the first set of logs. You see they're side by side by side. So the tricky part here is, you know, you got that 8 to 10 inch lip, but it's also long. So that length is a troublesome part as well.
So they have dealt with the barriers here on this lap. They've dealt with the logs, and that was the first time we've seen Branham really go smoothly over the logs thus far. The one obstacle remains is the sand pit. They'll be approaching that shortly.
First, we got to deal with these moderate hill, but these switchbacks are very tough because the problem is that you have a tight turn, which means you get down to a very low speed, and then you got to kick it back uphill. It's very short. The grade isn't very, you know, daunting when you're talking about going uphill, but from a dead stop, be in a low gear, get up, stand up out of the saddle, take a tight turn. I would just coast on the way down here because you have these switchbacks and hills. But you want to make sure you stay in a low gear. Now, what I want to see from Bethany is that if she gets to the top, stay out of the saddle, make the turn, throttle the gears up as high as you can. You got a downhill and a straightaway. This is a good opportunity to get a little bit more distance on second and third. Straight downhill, good straightaway. This is where you want to pick up as much speed as you can. That's a little bit too slow of a cadence. She might not have been ready to gear up that much. You want to see the feet moving all the time. It's not necessarily about the gear that you're in, but the cadence at which you're riding at. You want to see these feet spinning like crazy the whole time. And what you also want to see is their hands. They should be gearing up and gearing down the entire time.
So they've dealt with two of the three obstacles. The third is the sand pit. For more on this obstacle, we go to Amanda Krenz.
And here is the biggest challenge of that sand pit. It will slow you down. So the question is, how far can you get into the sand before that happens? So you want some momentum going into it. Something else you're going to see these athletes do is trying to follow in some of those tracks that have been created. It's a great idea until you get the smallest bit off of that track, and then you're in trouble. For some of these athletes, the most efficient way for them to handle it is going to be walk through that sand. So you're going to see a lot of different strategies here, guys.
Thank you, Amanda. And my question really is how much that has changed from what they practiced yesterday. We had that heavy downpour this morning, really kind of slickening up that, but it also could pack that sand in a little bit more.
Yeah, it'll pack the sand up a lot more, but it's just surface. So, you know, the rain isn't going to seep down too much, but I would like to see them shift down into a lower gear going into the sand, pedal hard through it, get as far as you can until you feel yourself starting to slow down. Dismount, sprint through, keep the bike on the ground, hands on the handlebars, so you can mount just as quickly on the way off. Toomey changed her strategy on this round, and that put her back in the second ahead of Jamie Green.
Green in the gray shirt on the right side of the screen is in third. Toomey in the white leader's jersey in the middle in second place, but the leader on the bottom of the screen in the dark gray pants is Bethany Branham, who took the lead early on in the lap number two and has extended that interval by a wide margin as we pass the 15-minute halfway mark in this 30-minute time cap event. Carol Ann Reason-Thibault trying to make a charge. She was 10th place after lap number one, but somebody with a boxing background, good endurance for her. This could be a nice moment to move back up the field in the last half of this event.
Well, she still's got to get over this last log obstacle before she gets into the turn. So she is behind these athletes quite a bit going into this point.
Back out in front, we're still looking at around an 8-second interval for the Games rookie, Bethany Branham. Good endurance background, has done many half marathons and triathlons as well. The first two events today really play well for her.
They do, especially with her skill set. And what you need to do when you get, you know, we'll say a bone throw your way, is you need to take advantage of the opportunities, especially being a rookie. Not just for placing on the leaderboard, but just confidence going into the weekend. The biggest thing for rookie athletes is they're very wide-eyed, they're very green, and the confidence is not nearly there because you see these athletes you've been watching on TV for the last 3 to 5 years.
Speaking of athletes that are green, Jamie Green moves into the second place position, but she's got a tight fight with Tia Claire Toomey as that fight for second continuing, and Green has cleared Toomey as she had the inside lane on that first turn in the switchbacks. Somebody that's been struggling today as one Australian leads the point standings. One is lagging well back in the field, and that's Cara Webb. Had a struggle early on in event number one, and she's sitting around that mid-pack position here in heat number one of this event. And the fight for second continues yet again. It'll be green on the inside of this turn, Toomey on the outside. Looks like that outside position kind of caught Toomey there a little bit as she got shifted and pushed a little bit away.
It was, and it wasn't a bad position to be in if Toomey could take advantage of that, because now she's on the inside. Well, she should have been on the inside, but if you're on the outside, these are switchbacks. You could be on the outside for one turn, but on the inside for another. So if Toomey could have swung around, listen, you can make contact out here. I'm not saying it's the most, you know, ethical way to race this bike, but I'm going to get inside when I can and take advantage of my positioning on these switchbacks.
Early on, I mentioned perhaps the person that had, if you want to go with the motocross terms, the best hole shot there at the start in that first turn, passing four people, was Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet. You see her on the right side of the screen. That might have been a little too hot for her right out of the gate, as she's fallen back down to the 14th position, 17 and a half minutes after lap number two, over 2 minutes behind the leader, Bethany Branham.
And not necessarily that she went out too fast, she's just not as fast as the other girls. As Branham, she picks up the bike on the shoulder, which is totally fine. If that's your comfortable position, whatever you're comfortable with, it's that mounting and dismounting. You see, having some trouble with the spokes. And really what you want to do is, too many of these girls are, for now, are trying to put their feet on the pedals before they mount the bike. Look, just get on the seat, you'll find your pedals. Toomey did a great job in that. Look at the advantage she just got over Jamie Green. Jamie Green was trying to find the pedals before she mounted the bike. Flip that, mount the bike, find the pedals. The pedals ain't going anywhere. Get on top and get your feet in, place second.
Branham continuing to hold a pretty significant lead over the points leader, Tia Claire Toomey and Jamie Green. All three of them were in the top five in qualifying yesterday. Branham with the fifth fastest lap in terms of this heat, at least. Toomey with the third, Green with the fourth. And they're all also in the top 10 in the point standings after the opening event, with Toomey the points leader, Green in fourth place, and Branham in eighth.
Here's that straightaway where you need to kick it up a gear, get out of the saddle, and start banging on the pedals. You do have these switchbacks on the hillside coming up next, where you need to be a bit more conservative, kind of plan your rest. You know, I say rest in quotation marks, but you can see there's a little bit of an upgrade on the incline here on the back half before we hit these hillside switchbacks.
And we talked about the experience factor, and that was a good job over those logs that time for Branham. We spoke about the experience factor. One of the things that Branham might have to deal with now is she has a good lead over Tia Claire Toomey and Jamie Green. There's still one heat remaining, and you're not going to know what those times are, and that becomes a factor here in this event.
It does become a factor because you're not just racing your heat, but the heat that's coming up after. But hopefully you have a coach that has done his due diligence and saying, if you're in the lead, do not sit back and coast, do not rest. And Branham runs into the wall. We saw her do that in practice, and now that lead, here's the problem. She's on the hillside, so this is really going to hurt her as Toomey is going to close up the distance. So like I said, as you can be out in the lead, you have one mix-up, especially in these switchbacks. Man, that you know, we'll see how that does for the rest of Branham, but she's lost plenty of time.
And that shaved about 5 seconds off the lead for Bethany Branham, as she wasn't even in a treacherous part, really. She just went a little too hot coming into those switchbacks and went way off track.
Well, here's the thing. When you're taking tight turns, where you look is how you set your bike and your line up. And what I mean by line is the path you want to take around the corners. Branham was looking exactly where she went into. When you're taking turns, you look down and to the inside of the turn. That will keep you online. See how she's keeping her eyes ahead? You want to look at the inside of that tarp. That will help your sight and keep your line straight around these tight turns.
And Tia Claire Toomey is looking forward, but she's not looking at the turn. She's looking at Branham, who has gotten closer and closer to the points leader, Tia Claire Toomey. And we've got a good race shaping up in the final third of this lap.
Now the question is that, did that rattle you? Did that make you hesitant to hit the sand pit, hit the turns in this last obstacle, knowing full well that one little mistake can mean the difference between leading the pack and getting behind Tia Claire Toomey?
Branham got about a third of the way through the sand pit before she dismounted, Toomey with a smoother transition off the bike. We'll see how they get back on. It's a walking pace for Branham. Toomey continuing to run, and she's right on the rear wheel of Bethany Branham, and we got a race for the lead once again.
And what did Toomey do? She jumped on the bike, found her feet. Branham screwing around with the pedals and trying to put her feet on first.
Tia Claire Toomey out in front once again for the first time since early on the lap number two, and we only have about a half mile remaining here in heat number one of cyclocross. And what was one of the things we've talked about all along? It's about your transition time, and that could be a huge factor, but Bethany Branham trying to close back in. They're side by side going into the turn. Branham on the outside, she loses pacing, adjusting her pants, and Toomey is going to pull away again.
Hey, man, you're racing. Let the butt cheeks hang out. You don't want to just pull up your pants and lose 10 feet. You got to gear up. This is the final turn. After this turn, it's a straightaway to the finish line. You need to gear up and kick towards the end.
In event number one, Tia Claire Toomey had to hold off Christy Aramo. She did so successfully, taking the event win. In event number two, heat number one, Tia Claire Toomey had to make a last lap pass on Bethany Branham. She did just that. Your heat one win will be for your points leader, Tia Claire Toomey, at right around 23 minutes.
The toughest part about this course is that it's not just the turns, the obstacles, the athletes, but you have to stay so dialed in and focused the entire time. One lapse of judgment, you know, looking off to the side, crashing into the wall, adjusting your shorts as you're trying to sprint towards the end. You had, you know, 200 meters left to go. It shouldn't matter what's going on. You have to be so focused the entire time. This is a huge mental grind on these athletes as well as this physical part.
Your pole sitter, for lack of better terms here, going with the racing terms, in this heat, Mackenzie Riley will be the fourth place finisher. And I believe that's Emily Abbott behind her. So the top five qualifiers here in this heat will be the top five finishers in heat number one. Reminder, there's still one heat remaining. We're gonna have heat one of the men's side of this coming up next, then heat two of the women's side. As Riley in fourth, Abbott in fifth. And now we'll wait. I believe it's gonna be Lauren Fisher that might continue that hard charge up through the field on this one. Nice race here. I believe that's Fisher and Carly Fuhrer behind her. And that is indeed Lauren Fisher in sixth, Carly Fuhrer in seventh. So Lauren Fisher, the one that made the big move here in heat number one, as she'll go from 11th place all the way up to sixth. Got China Cho finishing in eighth. Cara Webb looking to be in the ninth position. And this is about 2 minutes behind Tia Claire Toomey's winning time here in the heat. So there's significant time for heat number two athletes to wedge their way in and get into these positions as well. Carolyn Reason-Tebow finishing in 10th. Alessandra Pacelli coming across the line in 11th. As we have 5 minutes until the 30-minute time cap. This will be Madeline Sturt, youngest athlete in the field for the second consecutive year. She'll come across the line in 12th at 25:26. Carlene Matthews in position to be the 13th place finisher. She comes down the straightaway for the final time.
I'd say even for these athletes on the back half of this, not finishing in the top five, top 10, top 15, is that in the time trial, everything was separated by seconds. We had 20 places separated by 5 to 10 seconds. Now stretch that out over three laps. You know, these are very important positions to be in towards the end, so you got to finish strong.
Speaking of finishing strong, sprint to the finish. Margo Alvarez in a full sprint, trying to get by Camila Bach-Bazinet, who's fading late. This is fourth position, and it'll go to Margo Alvarez by about a half bike length. 1/18 of a second from Alvarez in 14th and LeBlanc-Bazinet in 15th. Every point matters at the end of the weekend. And Chelsea Hughes, who had a terrifying wreck yesterday in the time trials, will be the 16th place finisher. Nice recovery there. Another battle for position. This is Jessica Coughlin on the left, Reagan Huckabee on the right. Behind them, I believe, is Jessica Griffith.
And just look at the gears on the left side. You see, that is just too high. The cadence pace is like, you got to be up and out of it. And like I said, that's a little too slow going into those logs. You need to be on a lower gear and a higher cadence on the bike.
And what did we talk about early on? Situational awareness, and that almost came back against Reagan Huckabee as Coughlin had an issue there, nearly running into Huckabee. So Reagan will pull away from Coughlin. They're still both ahead of Griffith. This for 17th, 18th, and 19th. So we still have 2.5 minutes until that half-hour time cap. And Huckabee pulling away from both Coughlin and Griffith. And it'll be the game's veteran that'll win this three-way race ahead of the two rookies in the field. As Huckabee onto the final straightaway and crossing the line in 17th place at 27.52. Coughlin in 18th, 27.55. Griffith in at 27.57. And Alethea Boone will be the final athlete left on the course. As she comes down the straightaway for the final time here in cyclocross heat number one, Alethea Boone across the line at 28 minutes and 26 seconds. So we'll have everybody beat that 30-minute time cap here in heat number one. Remember, still one heat remaining in the women's side. That'll be after men's heat number one. But the leader after this first heat, Tia Claire Toomey, the points leader, 23.06.31 seconds. Bethany Branham, Jamie Green, Mackenzie Riley, three rookies behind her in second, third, and fourth. Emily Abbott rounding out the top five.
Well, coming right out of the gates, they were seated in their time trials from the day before, so there's big separation to start. And Toomey, who had the kick at the end in event number one, was off to a great start. Her and Jamie Green were going back and forth for quite a while. In fact, the entire time as that lead got passed off between the two. For the first two laps, you see athletes just getting used to these barriers, how to carry the bike, how to navigate through, how to mount and dismount the bike. But it was Green who took it deep into the sand pit, carrying and then setting it down. That's where she first passed Toomey. This was the last time you see Toomey carry the bike. She learned her lesson. And then Bethany Branham came in. This is the very beginning of that second lap where she passed Tia Claire Toomey and Jamie Green. And she put a substantial lead on these athletes going into the third lap, especially as she was very quick, light bike, easy for her. The one thing that we're talking about is keeping your eyes down and focused on the turn. She had her eyes up, hit the fence, lost half of the lead to Toomey and Green. And then watch her put her feet on the pedals, misstep. Toomey right on top, onto the bike. And this is where she made the pass at the very end. And Toomey, like I said, she has the kick with that track background. She's got power, she's got speed, and she has some unfinished business from the last 2 years, and give herself another first place finish in this heat.
Tia, you had a change of strategy in the sand pit. What exactly happened?
Well, I thought the best way was to carry your bike. And then I seen Jamie Green go past me. I was like, well, she's pushing, I'm going to push it too. So that definitely helped throughout the sand pit and was a lot easier, which made me, you know, make it a little bit easier for the second and third round.
So what sort of lesson did you learn then carrying the bike versus rolling the bike?
Just try and make life easier for yourself. Don't make it any harder than it has to be.
What was the hardest part of the course?
Probably actually jumping over the little hurdles. That was definitely pretty challenging, and I spiked the heart rate. And then you had to like really breathe it out, and there was a little bit of an incline, so that was definitely the hardest. Once you got through that, you're like, all right, I got this.
You're having a great day one so far, Tia.
Yeah, hopefully it keeps going.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
So Tia Claire Toomey, the event one winner, the points leader, and the heat one winner in event number two. as she leads the way. We'll have 20 women also coming up later on, but before we do that, we have men's heat one of cyclocross coming up next. Welcome back as we get ready from heat number one of the women's side to heat number one on the men's side of event number two of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. It's time for men's cyclocross action. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, Sam Farber with you here at the Dog Park venue at the Alliant Energy Center in Madison, Wisconsin. And it's the same thing we saw on the women's side. 1.5 miles every lap, 20 turns, 3 obstacles for cyclocross.
3 laps, 1.5 miles each. You got some switchbacks, you got some barriers, hill switchbacks, sand pit. Throw in a couple logs in there, 3 rounds. I cannot wait to see how some of these guys fare because we got a few guys in the bottom half coming into this.
In this heat, there's a couple of names that will be in this one that are in the top 10 of the point standings. That includes Travis Mayer, somebody to keep an eye on in this one. He's in ninth, but the points leader, Brent Fikowski, Yonikowski in second, Ben Smith in third. So we talked about the course layout. Let's talk about the bikes, and for that, we go to Sam Farber.
Guys, they're going to be riding Trek Excalibur 7 bikes. Some of the specs on it, 2.2-inch wide tires, and more importantly, about 28 pounds on this bike frame. Why is that important? They got to lift it up and down when they go through a lot of these obstacles, some of which are a little bit more difficult today now that we've had that sudden downpour.
And that wreaked havoc on the women's side at some points of this track. We saw a lot of passing for position on the slick portions. And here in heat number one for the men's side, the fastest qualifier was the sixth quickest in qualifying. That was Jason Carroll. He'll be in lane number one. Travis Mayer, Rob Forte, two athletes that could be very good in this one in 4 and 5. And farther back in the pack includes a couple of big names like Josh Bridges in 14th.
Well, Bridges needs to make up for that 32nd place finish he had in event number one. Very surprising, but we have Forte and Marin sitting in the front. And here's what we want to look for. Do you understand how to use the bike, the gears, the way to switch, the way to mount, the dismount, that gear knowledge? You got to throttle up when it's straight away, throttle down on the hills. You have to be aggressive on the course. Take inside turns. Take some chances. You hesitate, you die. You know, I want to see... some aggression out there, and I think we're going to get it in heat one for these guys.
10 seconds.
Let's go, Jim!
Expect turn one to be a little more aggressive on the men's side than on the women's side, just with the sheer speed that they're able to provide coming into turn number one. And this could be a little treacherous with the rain that we had this morning. It's going to be a little bit slick as we have 20 athletes making their way through the opening turn.
You see a cautious turn right there at the start as guys are kind of stop pedaling, making sure they get through the first turn clean. And now we have to go to these really tight switchbacks where there's only enough room for about 3 or 4 guys wide as these hairpin turns are coming up. And with the slick grass, you know, you can't take it too fast. Again, you got to take wide, and then you got to find your line. Keep your eyes down and inside.
Cole Sager came out with that football mentality, very aggressive, going from row number 2 all the way into the lead. But he's now been passed by two of the names that we thought would do well in this one, two motocross guys with their background. Travis Mayer out in front in white, Rob Forte in yellow in second.
Mayer keeping his eyes down and low into the turns, making sure his line on the bike is true. And I like how he gets out of the saddle quickly, finds his feet underneath him again, going into the final turn.
So Mayer in first, Forte in second. Cole Sager with a big jump early on up to third. And mention the motocross background for both Mayer and Forte. Obviously, these aren't motor-powered bicycles. They're bicycles. They're going to be a little bit different, but it does give them a little advantage when it comes to this type of racing.
The advantage is going to be how to look for the course, how to navigate the terrain with speed going into turns, because a lot of guys and don't understand, you know, how fast are you really supposed to be going into these tight turns straightaways. You throttle up, you put the pedal down. You get some advantages when you can. There's really not much room on this course specifically that there's going to be some breaks. This is one of them. Now you're on to the sand, the dirt. This is a lot more flat than it was previously, so you want to not rest too much here, but this might be your only time for a break since we're going to go into the barriers and those switchbacks on the hill.
It's going to be some real quality. Wow, that was a tight turn there in that sharp hairpin. I believe that was Sager and Agidius. nearly colliding going around that turn. That in the fight for third. It's Mayer out in front as they go through the barricades for the first time, and we're seeing some quick transitions on and off the bike.
Now, it's more what we're looking for in heat one on the women's side is that you got to get off the barriers quick, get onto your bike even quicker. Don't worry about trying to place your feet to start. Those pedals will be there once you get on. So get on top of the seat, find your feet, and then gear up and get back onto the course.
See Sager falling off the pace a little bit. Your top five, now the same that was the top five on the qualifying order. So row one holding positions, one through five, as we're about halfway through the opening lap.
Now all these guys have been through this course twice. They went yesterday, they did a practice lap and a time trial lap. And what they should have done the practice lap is get a feel for the turns, the terrain, the elevation. On the time trial, you should just try to see how fast you can go recklessly, because there really is nothing, there's no consequences yesterday. Also to get an idea of how fast you go and how you feel after a particular lap.
I could be mistaken, but I'm wondering if Jason Carroll, he's in the green tank top, if he's having some type of issue with his bike, maybe a gear or a chain or something, because he keeps looking down at that bike and trying to kind of awkwardly moving on it, almost like he's feeling it out for some reason.
Well, sometimes, you know, if you're riding through wet grass, it did rain. If you're in the wrong gear and you're putting a little bit too much torque into the pedals, you can slip the chain off of those gear pegs.
Carroll continuing to hold the fourth position behind that man, Travis Mayer, who's led really since about the second or third turn when Cole Sager went on that kamikaze pace early on and took a brief lead, but it went right to Travis Mayer, and he's opened up about a 5-second lead over Rob Forte in second.
We're talking about knowing what gear you're supposed to be in. On these tight hairpin turns on the hillside, it's a light hill, but if you're in the wrong gear, it can be a hard climb, even though it's about 20 yards. You want to be in a low gear, tight turns, fast, get up out of the saddle on the way up, coast on the way down. They're going to have a little bit of a straightaway after this turn. So you want to gear up, hit that straightaway, try to get about, you know, 10 to 15 more feet on the rest of the field while you can.
On the women's heat number one, we saw the pacing drop off about 40 seconds from the laps that we saw in time trials. See what we have here on the men's side, but I would expect somewhere around that same, maybe 30, 40 seconds on the drop off.
Yeah, we did see about a pace of 30 seconds off. It's only a mile and a half, so when you have 30 seconds off a six-minute pace, that is quite significant as far as redlining is concerned. And now here's a couple different options, right? We have guys dismounting on the side. They're keeping their bike on the dirt, not carrying the bike. I like to see that. You don't really need to carry it through the sand pit. You can rest on the handles. That makes it a little bit easier to run through. What I want to see is that will guys take a chance to see how far they can coast into the sand before they dismount.
And we have had a gigantic shakeup of the top five going through that sand pit. Mayer was in the lead. He's now in second. BK Goodmanson was fourth. He's now out in front. So it's Bjorgvin Carl Goodmanson in the lead in the yellow tank top. Jason Carroll in the green tank top has moved into second. In third place is Frederick Agidius in the yellow t-shirt. He's side by side with Travis Mayer in white. Rob Forte has fallen from second down to fifth.
But he's still in that lead pack, and that's all you really need to be when on this first lap. Now this is where we have the turn, long turn, slightly uphill after the last set of logs, and then we have a downhill and a straightaway. You want to see them get in the highest gear that they can still maintain a high cadence. Being in a high gear and a slow cadence is not advantageous because it's putting too much stress on the legs. Get in a high gear that keeps you in a cadence about 90 to 100 revolutions per minute. Hit the straightaway and thin out the pack. It's not necessarily all about getting a lead, but more about not bunching up, because when we hit these tight turns, you want to take turns without having someone in your way. Get some distance on the rest of the field so that the turns can be free for you.
Jason Carroll's time trial time was 6 minutes 19 seconds, his first lap here, and that includes going from that standstill start, 6 minutes 53 seconds. So we're looking at about 35 seconds, the difference from time trial to this race condition, and only 10 seconds separating your top five who are in exact order of where they qualified in time trials yesterday.
See Carroll's cadence. It's a very slow. He's in a high gear. He's a strong guy, but that is going to take a lot of energy out of your legs. This is only the second lap. I really like the cadence on the back two athletes behind him, where he's cycling through very quickly. He's not necessarily gaining any ground, but he's not working any harder. Look how hard Carroll's having to work. He's out of his saddle, slow cadence into the turn. I want to see athletes be in a lower, lighter gear, because the in and out, you'll be able to start quick and finish the turns quicker.
Side-by-side race for position. Agidius on the outside, Carroll on the inside. That will change as they go through the switchbacks, of course. And Carroll will hold that lead position.
Look at the cadence you see on Agidius. That's a much smarter way to do it. Carroll is working way too hard. Look how slow he is in and out of the turns. Agidius' cadence, this is exactly what you need to see. This is where having knowledge of how to use a bike, whether it's elevation or turns, you're slow out of the turn, which means you need to be in a lower gear.
I feel like we saw two smart moves there. Agidius for the smart move on the pacing going into the turn. Carroll for the smart move on the block that he put in that turn, cutting off Bjørgen Carl Gudmundsen by just that little bit, closing that door on him before he can get around.
Yeah, these guys are being way too nice out here on the racetrack. You got to get position. This is your race. You're riding with 20 other people, but who cares? This is your position. Cut. Take the inside, take the outside, swing wide on your turns. Don't worry about people next to you.
And Gudmundsen will get the pass this time on Jason Carroll on the straightaway. And Carroll almost looked like he just gave him the position at that point, just trying to stay in his pace that he's got.
Well, if Carroll's coach is out there on the side when he passes him, he has to tell him to shift down into a lighter gear.
Over the barriers for lap number two. All three looking about level in terms of pacing, and they come out three wide out of the barriers. Carroll stumbles a little bit getting onto the bike, and it's Agidius and Gudmundsen side by side for the lead here on lap number two.
Good transitions for all three athletes. They were able to plant their foot, hop on the bike, and get right into pedaling. As you see, Agidius is staying in that low gear. Gudmundsen just behind him. Carroll is still in that high gear. I don't know if he switched gears one time in this lap and a half so far.
That still makes me wonder, when we were looking at him looking at the bike, if there's some type of gear issue that he's having. 10 minutes in, 30-minute time cap here in heat number one of men's cyclocross. It's event number two here on the opening day of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. Your three leaders were the three fastest qualifiers here in heat number one. It's Frederick Agidius out in front, Bjørgen Carl Gudmundsen in second, and Jason Carroll in third.
I think one thing Gudmundsen needs to be careful of is that he's taking the turn, but he's putting his foot down. You don't really need to do that on a bike too much. You want to be careful is that you lose your footing getting back onto the pegs, because the trick here is that these aren't clip-in shoes, so your foot can slide off these very easily, and if you're putting your foot down in wet grass, that makes it even harder to keep your foot in contact with the pegs.
That was very smooth for what could have been a treacherous moment. Three wide over the logs. One of them falls. Well, all of them might fall at that point, but they all make it through very cleanly as Gudmundsen takes the lead ahead of Agidius in second, Carroll in third. Mayer and Forte have fallen off that lead pack by a significant margin.
Second time they're navigating through these, low-setting hill switchbacks, but this is where you can make up very valuable seconds or really have an advantage of not working harder than you need to. I say this, stay in a low gear, get up out of the saddle on the climbs. It's only going to take about 10 pedals to get up through that. A little sprint, relax on the downhills. Here you have the turn, and you got a straightaway coming up. Shift into a higher gear, but make sure your cadence can stay high. You don't want to be having slow pedal strokes. All that means is that you might be going the same speed, but you're working harder to get there. Hit about that middle gear range. I mean, the range on these bikes is quite extensive, but you're after one lap or two lap, you start to find the sweet spot for you and your bike. It's not the same for everyone, so it's what you can tolerate. Carroll, strong athlete, can stay in that high gear, but it's going to end up working against him towards the end.
And it can all change when it gets to the sand pit. We saw it in lap one. We'll see it in lap two. For more on this obstacle, we go to Sam Farber.
And what a difference a day makes in terms of this obstacle. Yesterday, when these athletes did their time trial, it wasn't wet out here. It was a much, much different sand trap than it is today. Now, it could get easier for some athletes as that sand's a little bit more compacted on top. But once you start to sink, it's going to be tough to get out. Now, again, it's different from yesterday. So whatever strategy these athletes had coming into this event, it might have changed. We'll see what they do second and third time through that sand pit.
Thanks, Sam. And that battle again shapes up through the sand pit as Agidius retakes the lead over Goodmanson. We've seen several passes here on the middle lap of competition. That was a full-blown jump by Goodmanson there over that log this time.
I mean, if you're comfortable on a bike, you can clear those logs and never actually have to touch them. The trick there is that it's a little bit harder when you have this pedal option, right? There's no cage where you can slip your foot into and have contact fixing you to the bike. It's just loose, you don't have clip-ons, and what you'd see with, say, a normal cyclocross bike is that their foot or their shoes clip onto the pedals, and when you can do that, you can pull up the front wheel and then pull your heels, and that'll pull the back wheel up and over. It's not going to work with these bikes.
So two laps down, one lap remains for your top three, but it's a different story for Rob Forte, who is being passed now, or perhaps being passed by Noah Olsen. This is around that top five position, maybe fifth, sixth, or seventh for these two as Olsen goes around Forte. And Rob Forte, one of the favorites that we were talking about off air and on air for this event, really struggling here for what we were expecting.
Carroll's still hanging tough behind him, but look how hard he is working to stay with that group. The other guy is a very quick cadence, light pedals, and that's what you want to see is quick revolutions on the bike. And this is the third lap. They've had two opportunities, and when you get used to the course, this is where you can see them start to take, I would say, more chances, not unnecessary chances, but a comfortability factor. You've gone through twice. You know where you fit best. Is it the straightaways, the turns, maybe these hairpins off the quick? Maybe it's the back half of this. Maybe it's the sand pit. You figured it out. You should have your race strategy dialed in for this final lap.
Carroll perhaps looking to make a move, but he got a little squirrely there going into that turn. Drifted out wide, nearly went into that heavier grass, the rough, if you will, if you want to use a golf term here on this one. And he lost a little bit of that push that he had trying to make that overtake on Goodmanson.
Now, Carroll loses contact with these guys on the turns because he's in too high of a gear. But he's so strong and aggressive is that he catches up very easily on these mid-range short straightaways. So if Carroll can stay close to these guys, especially after the final log obstacle, he's in a high enough gear that when they start coming towards the turn and the finish, if he has enough energy left, can finish well.
And the number one key that we spoke about earlier was gear knowledge. Perhaps this whole time when Carroll was looking at the bike and trying to, it looked like something was wrong. Maybe he was just figuring out what gear he needed for this point of the event.
And you can see that because there's two different sections on here where you can see where the chain's sitting. If it's sitting on the smaller ones towards the middle, that means you're in a lighter gear. If it's in the higher, bigger gears, right, those are the ones you want to be on for straightaways like this.
Looked like Carroll was about to make a push at the end of that straightaway, and Goodmanson kind of put the throttle down a little bit more and tried to pull away, but all three of them approach the barricades nearly side by side by side. It's three wide for the lead to the barricades for the final time.
So we're the final barrier, and here's what you see. Foot on, foot over. That's great transition from all three. We saw them do it on the first two laps, so final time, they're going over the barriers, and now we're going to get into those tight switchbacks on the hill. Stay in a low gear. Take a tighter turn. The turns are going to switch your position, so you got to make sure you're always trying to get that inside track on these turns.
Continues to be relatively three wide. They're all within a length of each other. Going into that tight hairpin to start these switchbacks coming up.
And they're still staying seated on the turns. I know these guys are moving very quickly, but get out of the seat. It's easier to pedal up hills standing up when you do it when you're talking about such a short distance to go. Take a turn, stand up, sprint. It's going to be a 3 to 5 second sprint. Get up, get on your bike, and then find your pace after that.
And with a race this intense for these three athletes, you got to draw back also to what happened earlier today with that 5K run broken up with that 500-meter swim in the middle. Now this and the push that they're having on the bikes, you know their legs are absolutely burning here on the final lap of cyclocross here in heat number one.
I mean, their legs have been burning since the start over this. But these guys look really comfortable on their bikes. Carroll Silly, he's still in that high gear, but he'll catch up. He'll catch up to these guys because when you get to the straightaway, it's better be in that high gear, just not on the turns.
Question for him at this point might be how far away is he from the lead when he gets to that final straightaway. He could have the power to overtake, but he's got to be close enough to be within striking distance to do so. Goodmanson pulling away from Agidius and Carroll, trying to prevent that last second push from Carroll from happening.
What I want to see is get up. There you go. Get up out of the saddle. Sprint up the hill. Coast down the hill. Just lay off the pedals. Keep your inside foot high so you can take a tighter turn. You don't want that inside foot down. It's going to hit the ground when you do that. Keep the inside foot high. Coast around the turn. Get up out of the saddle on the hills. I like that. That's what I'm wanting to see.
Quick pace on the downhill for Bjorgvin Carl Goodmanson. He continues to lead the way over Frederick Agidius in second, Jason Carroll in third. As we come up to the sand pit for the final time, and this has been the big shakeup element of this race. Each time we've gotten there, we've seen some changes for critical positioning. They'll come around this turn and then they hit the sand for the final time.
If Carroll wants a shot to stay with him, he has to get through the sand smoothly, hit the turn, and start dancing on those pedals because he is in a higher gear. He's going to lose some contact right off the turn.
Goodmanson went deep into the sand, but the transition was a little bit slower. Agidius ran it through most of the way. He had a quicker transition in, but a slower transition out. They continue to hold 1, 2, 3. Goodmanson, Agidius, and Carroll. Carroll trying to go around on the outside for second.
They have a short hill before they hit the final logs, and you got to hit here with speed, but you have to be slightly in control. If you crash here, it's over.
Every time these three spread apart from each other, they bunch right back up as they approach the logs for the final time. All three looking smooth.
Now we have a bit uphill into this long turn before the final stretch. Carroll needs to stay close, but if Goodmanson and Agidius know what they're doing, they need to gear up out of this final turn because we have a straightaway downhill to finish out.
And this could be great news for all three of them when it comes to the overall placing. One heat remains after this one, but with the intensity of this race, including this push right, Jason Carroll around the outside. He goes around Agidius for second. He's battling now with Goodmanson for the lead. Side by side, it looks like he got near the wall on that one, and it might be just enough to keep Goodmanson out in front. They're side by side to the line. Give it to Bjorgvin Carl Goodmanson, winner of heat number one. Jason Carroll in second, Frederick Agidius in third, separated by just over 2 seconds, first through third.
I said if Carroll could stay close, he was in a high gear the whole time, but it would pay off on the final turn and straightaway. That was enough to pass Agidius, but Goodmanson held on.
And that chain looks real loose for Travis Mayer. And it sounds like he actually had to repair that chain, jumped off, fixed it real quick, and back onto the bike as Mayer continuing to hold on to the fourth position, well behind that top three.
And that's really unfortunate to have, you know, the equipment kind of take you out of contention in this heat. Now everyone's riding the same thing. This is part of the race, it's part of the sport. What you need to understand is like how you shift and when you shift on those gears. If you hit some bumps and turns, shift mid-gear, you can lose the chain. If you shift too drastically from 27 to 12, that can lose the chain.
So Mayer will be fourth. Rounding out the top five will be Noah Olson in fifth. He'll be the only one that started outside of row number one to finish in the top five. And Paul Castillo will finish in sixth place. That's not too surprising with the amount of sprint triathlons he's done. He's gotten very comfortable on the bike as of late. Rob Forte, one of the favorites in this one, will be the seventh place finisher. Nice race for eighth. This is Cole Sager out in front, just ahead of Tim Paulson. So our top nine are in at right around the 22-minute mark, 8 minutes until the 30-minute time cap. Another one of the rookies, Tommy Vinas, will be the 10th place finisher. So the top 10 in qualifying will be the top 10 in the event results. 11th place will be Jeff Patzer, another games rookie. And then one of the more veteran athletes you can have in the field, Scott Panchik, will be in 12th. Michael Palomba will be the 13th place finisher. Zeke Grove, new father, as he and his wife welcomed a baby about a month ago, will be 14th place here in this event. Travis Williams in 15th. And that leaves behind some very familiar names in this field, as Cody Anderson, second time he's been to the games, will be our next finisher in 16th. And how about the names that are left? Alex Smith, Garrett Fisher, and Josh Bridges will be the final three here in this one, as Fisher crosses the line in 17th. And for Josh Bridges and Alex Smith, this is trouble, especially with the troubles that they had earlier in event number one.
Yeah, not an ideal start for these athletes. Yeah, Alex Smith, we knew he probably wouldn't be the best at some of these more longer endurance ones. He's waiting to hope that we have some gymnastics and heavy barbells later in the weekend. But, you know, Josh Bridges, not a good start in event one. Definitely not what he wanted to happen in event two.
He's got the look that he knows that was a rough time there, as he comes across the line in 18th here in the heat. Still 20 athletes left to go after this one. We'll have women's heat number two coming up next, then men's heat number two, as Alex Smith, the last remaining athlete on the course. Still about 6 minutes until that half-hour time cap, though.
And I think a lot of times people see is a bike out there, and this is much harder than it looks. You know, just what a bike feels like. It's not like an assault bike. You know, you sit on there for 50 cows, 100 cows. It's just completely different. You know, you got to have the endurance, the legs, what that run, swim, run does to your legs. I think not a lot of people really were expecting to feel those in this event.
So just like we saw in heat one of the women's side, the top points athlete in event number one wins the heat here in event number two. Bjorgvin Carl Gudmundsson was fourth place earlier today. First place here in the heat, just ahead of Jason Carroll by about a half second. But it wasn't without plenty of lead changes along the way.
Oh, we had a nice sprint start to the first turn. And Travis Mayer is in that light gray shirt in the sea of green, kind of the outside looking in, but he started very quick. Gudmundsson behind Sager. Sager made a big push right off the bat. Mayer came inside. And, you know, and Mayer's one of those athletes who we thought would do well. Didn't do poorly, just didn't finish quite as high as we thought. And then we had the top three slowly shifting through. Bjorgvin Carl Gudmundsson, Jason Carroll behind him, with Mayer sitting in that second place position. And then this is where the top three started to separate themselves from the rest of the field, as Agidius, Carroll, and Gudmundsson were going side by side by side throughout pretty much the 2.5 laps after the first hairpin turns. And it went from Carroll to Agidius, from Agidius to Bjorgvin Carl Gudmundsson. This inside turn right there, easy over the logs, and that gave him a good position to get ahead and into the lead. And these guys' dismounts and transitions were flawless the entire time, especially through the sand pits. But Bjorgvin Carl Gudmundsson, he can actually clear the whole set of logs. The back tire didn't touch, the front tire didn't touch. And I said Carroll was in a high gear the whole time, too high, but it was enough at the end because he had the downhill turn that straightaway to the finish, but it was just a little too late as Gudmundsson was able to hold on to the finish.
That distance, only about one bike length between them, and a smooth dismount for the heat winner, Bjorgvin Carl Gudmundsson, who's with Sam Farber.
Bjorgvin, you were in a big race there, a three-way race pretty much the entire time. You didn't lead any lap until the last one. How did you plot your pacing throughout this race?
Well, soon in the race, it was me, Jason, and Frederick that was leading. I just kind of kept on their tails. Sometimes I passed them, and that's the last stretch. I just try to win it, man. Just try to overtake them.
Jason really pushed you there in that last turn for home. Did you notice him, and what were you doing to keep him behind you there in that final home stretch?
Yeah, I noticed him soon enough so I could gear up and go for it. I knew that he was gonna try to take over, and I just tried to keep the first place.
When you guys first learned about this event via social media, all you saw was a bike. How did your preparation for a bike event compare to what you just did today?
We didn't do too much of mountain biking. We did like two trainings, and then at home I have mountain bike and a lot of good tracks, so I can go there and play.
Jorvin, thank you.
Thank you so much.
So a good first day for Bjørgvin Carl Gudmundsson, fourth place in event number one. He's the current leader with one heat remaining in men's cyclocross. We'll get ready for heat number two of women's action coming up next.
Okay.
We've seen running, we've seen swimming. It's time for some biking for heat number two of women's cyclocross, event number two at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, Amanda Krenz with you at the dog park here at the campus of the Alliant Energy Center in Madison, Wisconsin, as heat number two ready to go. And in this one, we won't see the points leader, Tia Claire Toomey. She's the clubhouse leader after heat number one. But we will see Christy Aramo and Samantha Briggs, who round out the top three in the point standings after our opening event. And the second event involves this 1.5-mile track.
Oh, we got 3 laps, 1.5 miles, some hairpin turns, jumping over some logs, some barriers, more turns on the hill. That sand trap in that final set of logs into that straightaway. These guys are going to have to, or these ladies are going to have to navigate not just the barriers, but the number of people on the course this time, different than those time trials yesterday.
So we'll have 20 athletes fighting the obstacles, including the barriers. For more on those, we go to Amanda Krenz.
And those barriers are what Tia Toomey said are the hardest part of the course. Now, she, of course, is the winner of the women's heat that went first. Maybe they don't look that daunting, but if you are riding as a bike as hard as these athletes are pushing, and then you have to get off of it and carry that bike over these obstacles, they could give you some trouble. You're going to see athletes try different strategies, but they want to be as smooth as possible. We always talk about efficiency and transitions, and this is where these precious seconds are going to pay off.
Thank you, Amanda. And here in heat number two, we'll have 20 athletes working through this one as 3 laps on this 1.5 mile track. And it almost looks like it was set up this way, but it really wasn't. Second, third, and fifth in the point standings are in lanes 1, 2, and 5. They were the 3 fastest qualifiers overall in the time trials yesterday. And there's a couple of names that look to be making their move up the way. And that includes Christy Aramo, lane number 12, Brooke Wells in lane number 19. But somebody to definitely keep an eye on in this one, Sam Briggs, who will be in lane number 2.
Oh, I don't think she's any worried about, you know, exchanging a little paint off the bikes with some of these fellow athletes on the competition field. So I'm curious to see if she can stay aggressive, take the turns, you know, make sure you work the gears, right? Hit the straightaways and push the pace.
And one lane behind her, one of the two-time games champions on the women's side of the field, Annie Thorisdottir.
Same thing, is that you just got to understand your pace. You got to understand the course itself. They've gone through it twice. They'll have 3 laps here this morning. And you're going to get that first lap as kind of a feeler. The second one is maybe ingrain your pace if you make good decisions or bad. I want to see them race on that third one.
The second two-time and the two-time reigning champion of the CrossFit Games, Katrin Davidsdottir, also in this heat.
Well, I'm sure she's visualized this course about 15 different times and just making sure she knows where the turns are supposed to be, the hills, the downside, where to shift up, where to shift down. So it's more about running your race. There's 20 people here, but you got to understand is that it's still you out there.
And the pole sitter, for lack of better terms here, Kristen Holter, the fastest qualifier in time trials one day ago. She will be out in lane number 1.
Someone not afraid to hurt, not afraid to have a little bit of endurance. It's a longer event. One of those things we always see her do well in. And like I said, you just got to understand how to use that bike and race the field that you're in.
Thank you.
So we've seen one heat of women's action. We'll have heat number 2 and expect it to be similar here when it comes to what it will take to succeed.
You know, and I just touched on that, is that getting in and out of the turns at the right gear ratio. If you're on a straightaway, you want to be in a high gear, but make sure that the cadence isn't too slow. When you're taking turns, be in a low gear, be able to get in and out of slow points, up hills, get over the barriers. That situational awareness, when to push, when to slow down, how your transitions are going to work through all these obstacles along the course. If you're in a group of 3 around turns, fight for the inside position and get inside in a good position.
So we've spoke about the obstacles. Let's talk about the bikes a little bit. For more there, we go to Amanda Krenz.
Yeah, the bikes these guys are going to be riding are Trek Excalibur 7s. They are 2017 models. The bikes weigh 28.4 pounds. There is a smaller frame size that a lot of these women are using, and that's based off of the bike fitting that they did. The tires are 2.2 inches wide. They have 2 different diameters, again, depending on that smaller frame or not. Those diameters are 27.5 inches or 29 inches. That smaller frame and size are going to be better for those smaller athletes.
Away we go with heat number 2, trying to chase down the time of 23:06.31 seconds set by the points leader, Tia Claire Toomey, in heat number 1, as they come screaming down the straightaway into turn 1 for the first time with the fastest qualifier, Kristen Holta, on the inside of that turn. But it might not work out for her, as on the outside, it's Anna Tobias, who will take the lead out of turn number 1.
You know, the first turn is important, but it's not imperative. We have 3 laps to go. We got a long time. A lot of things can change. You just want to make sure that you get out of the gates clean. You get through the first turn, maybe in that lead pack, but not packed together. There's plenty of opportunity on this course, even in just 1 lap alone, to make some passes. You don't want to put yourself in a bad position on this first set of turns.
And just to show how important getting that front row positioning was in time trials yesterday, the top five in the time trials are the top five coming into this turn. And a little bit of a hiccup for Katrin David's daughter, who got snagged on that hay bale on the inside of the turn.
And what the problem here is going in, you know, after multiple heats go through this course, is that the course will start to take its own kind of shape. It's going to change every lap with people digging into the turns. It rained earlier this morning quite a bit, and so that's going to soften up the ground. You got to make sure is that you have your sight on the bike and where you should turn. But eventually, you know, that's going to dig its own little position. So you got to make sure is that you're not too far inside or too far wide, because those hay barrels will catch you up if you're too close.
Looked like a little bit of a correction there from David's daughter, too. That time swung out wide and then cut in the middle of the turn as opposed to starting on the inside.
And that's the adaptability that you want to see from athletes, especially veterans, is that, look, I made a mistake in this part. I'm not going to make it again. We saw Tia Claire Toomey do that in the first heat, carrying her bike through the sand pit in lap one, pushing her bike through the sand pit in two and three, and that ended up actually passing in her into that first place position on that third lap.
This is what we were speaking about a moment ago with Katrin kind of getting stuck on that hay bale on the inside of the turn, losing the position that she had over Kristen Holta, who moved into the third place spot, but only a one position shift there from that small mistake in the turn.
And we have this first straightaway. It's on the pavement, or not the pavement, but the dirt road. So this is an opportunity where you can speed up and not necessarily looking for position, but just lengthen out, thin out the pack, get the people around you away from you moving into these barriers.
Early dismount for Sam Briggs, who's taken the lead going to the barriers. And that allows Kristen Holta to catch up. They're side by side getting back onto the bike out of that obstacle. So your two fastest qualifiers, Holta on the inside, or on the left side, Briggs on the darker shirt, one and two once again here in the race.
I think one thing I'd like to see from Salmon is to sit a little bit more forward on the seat. You can see the seat is really far in front of her. Sit on the very edge, and where the advantage is look where her foot finishes relative to her hips. It's really far forward, so you don't really get to use as much of the power in your legs as you could sitting a bit more on top of the pedals.
Seeing the top four separate themselves from the field, especially that top two of Briggs and Holta, as Tobias in third, David's daughter in fourth, and Reed Berline rounding out the top five, your top five qualifiers in time trials yesterday, the top five here at the halfway point in our opening lap.
One thing I'm seeing from Briggs is that she's taking advantage of the straightaways when she can. She kicks it into a little bit higher gear and pushes the pace. And we saw during all these time trials yesterday is these are going to be some of the more treacherous obstacles for these athletes.
And somebody's got an issue with the bike. We're trying to figure out who that is. That's Carrie Pierce, the fifth place finisher from 1 year ago, as her bike has broken. She's got to carry that bike. It looks like it's a chain issue that trying to be sorted out, but she's got to get to that.
Okay, it's not broken per se, unless there's something that we don't really see, but the chain came off, and the chain can get stuck in between the gears or the bike, not pedals, but kind of the shaft is where.
Another one with issues.
Sigmund's daughter.
Yeah, that is Sarah Sigmund's daughter, and that could be huge in terms of point. No, that is not. That's Cassidy Lance McWhorter. Another issue, Casey Campbell.
And so here's the deal with this. If you go too slow, you're going to hit that back tire too dead on, and that's going to pop your chain off for these bikes. You know, you can go a little too fast, but it's almost like, this is bad to say, but like big speed bumps in neighborhoods, the faster you go, it's actually less detrimental on the car. You just kind of pop right over the top of them. Not saying I do that in my neighborhood, but someone told me is that if you go faster, they're not quite as hard on the car. I do that.
We'll just leave that there as we work our way towards the sand pit for the first time here in this race. Lap one of three. It continues to be Sam Briggs out in front. Kristen Holta in second. Katrin David's daughter has made the pass on Anna Tobias for third. They continue to hold those four lead positions.
Now, I like how deep Katrin went in. You can see her in the blue just below Briggs and Holti, how far she went into the sand pit. That's a good strategy. Get as far as you can if you can just rest and roll on the bike and then pop off and run.
So one thing that we do want to talk about here with that also, and we saw the bikes that were being pushed or carried from having those issues, Carrie Pierce most notably on that one, having to run with the bike. There is a pit area, for lack of better words. It's in the back of the course. You got to get there somehow with your bike. You can't just pick up a new one.
Yeah, they said you had to run your bike all the way to the pit area, and that is at the start point. And where Carrie Pierce broke down is in maybe the midway point of this course. But that second set of logs is different than the first. The first one, it's three side by side. The second one, it's one stacked onto two. So it's shorter, but it is higher. And that's the one that gave most of these ladies a problem yesterday during these time trials.
And those logs now complete for the first time by both Sarah Sigmund's daughter in the yellow top. We saw Christy Aramo, the second points position athlete, going by those logs as well. And look at this lead by Samantha Briggs. Talking about a good 8 to 10 second differential from Briggs to Holta. And this feels like the Tour de France, watching these athletes make their way through this crowd. They are showing their support on a rainy and cold morning here in Madison.
Well, there's that final turn, that downhill slide and straightaway. So it's good to see these top two female athletes gear up and sprint forward. I would like to see people get up out of their seat a little bit more and push the pace.
And somebody that has shown over the years she definitely can push the pace is Sam Briggs, looking to be just the third athlete in games history to reach double-digit event wins in her career. She's sitting at 9. Only Rich Froning and Annie Thorisdottir have more. If she wants to do that, she'll have to beat the pace not only of Kristen Holta behind her, but the pace that was set by Tia Toomey in heat number one of 23 minutes, 6.31 seconds.
Just look at the lead she's put on after the first lap alone. Now, what's nice here is that you've got, well, I'll say, quote, clear water, right? There's nobody around you. You don't have to worry about navigating around other athletes. The downside is that you don't really have anybody racing you. But in terms of where you want to be, I'm happy to be in front and just to put my nose down and start sprinting. The pace is the pace. And what it is this, it's not a dead sprint, but it is a maximal effort the entire time based off the length of this event. We're not saying this is a 30 cal sprint for time, but this is making sure you're gearing up, gearing down at the right positions, and then putting effort into the position of the course. So if it's uphill, low gear, push the pace. Downhill, lay off the pedals and maybe gear up a little bit so you can pick up some much needed speed on those straightaways.
Katrin David's daughter finds herself in third place, 13 seconds behind Sam Briggs in the lead after lap number one. And that was a quick lap of 7 minutes and 12 seconds by Briggs. That first lap, 20 seconds quicker than any lap we saw in heat number one. The fastest one there, 7:32 by Tia Claire Toomey on lap three.
Well, if you're going to put an event that requires 20-plus minutes of maximal exertion from just pure cardio perspective, there's only one athlete you're going to pick to succeed more often than not in an event like that, and that's Sam Briggs. Holti, again, we said she'd be good at this. It is more of those just work, endurance, suffering for a long period of time. She just needs to put a little bit more power into that bike, and I'm just not sure she has enough relative to what Sam Briggs can do. Even though it's a pretty big lead, these obstacles, especially with these barriers, logs, and that sand pit, can prove to be detrimental if you, A, you wipe out, B, you take a bad turn, you use the wrong sight around these corners. So a lot can change this only being the second lap.
We've said a lot about two of the champions here in this heat. Sam Briggs, the 2013 champion out in front. Katrin Davidsdottir, the two-time defending champion, in third. New athlete in fifth place is the 2011 and 2012 champion, Annie Thorisdottir, who's the first time we've seen anybody from outside of that front row in qualifying make their way into the top five, as Annie has moved from ninth place up to fifth.
I like the cadence she has. It's very quick. It seems like the pedals are light, especially when you get to these tight turns. You want that. And the deal is that it's not so much having a low gear for low gear's sake. And what I mean is just it's going to make the pedaling easier. But when you're coming out of a turn, you're moving very slow. When you get on the back half of this lap, you're also going slightly uphill. To be able to start quicker at a lower gear is such an advantage, not just on how to get to speed faster, but how much of a toll it takes on your legs getting in and out of those turns.
Large lead continues to be held and, in fact, increased by Sam Briggs over Kristen Holta. They continue to be first and second, as they have been really since the beginning of this one.
Now, we know based off qualifying that Holta does have the speed available if she needs it, maybe on that third lap. If I were her, it's like, as long as I'm not losing ground, maybe I can catch up, depending on some of these tight turns, is to stay close for the first two, maybe make a move on the last turn of the third lap.
So we've talked about Katrin Davidsdottir. We've talked about Annie Thorisdottir. How about Sarah Sigmundsdottir, who currently sits in the seventh position here in this heat? And that was the finish that she had in event number one as well. So somebody that's been a huge threat to possibly be the champion this year, one of the favorites if you're looking for somebody to pick that might not be the defending champion, finding herself with seventh and seventh, not too terrible thus far, but she might need to pick it up a little bit more if she wants to make that push to get her first championship.
What you want to make sure is that you take advantage of the opportunities that you have. And we're talking about missing top three. She's sitting in third 2 years in a row. That second first place position is taking advantage of the one place you might be able to pick up day one, event one, that second place positioning on, you know, something like this. So this adds up. It's a very, very long weekend. This is only the second event of many that they have over the next 4 days.
Briggs with an issue on the dismount of the bike getting into that sand pit, and Kristen Holta has now moved side by side as they work their way. This is where we've seen the most amount of passes in any point when it comes to that lead battle throughout either the men's side or the women's side. That sand pit has been a difference maker.
Now, Sam's gear changing is the difference between losing the lead for good and getting back into that first place position. But what her problem is that dismount. She hopped straight off the bike and had her legs still straddling that middle support bar. You need to hop laterally off the side of the bike so that you can get your feet into the sand and running. That was a mistake on Sam Briggs. I hope she fixes that in that third lap, because this is too close to the finish to where that could cost her in the end if she doesn't remedy that dismount.
Now, even before the sand pit, Holta was closing in the gap just a little bit. You saw that interval shrink down, and then the sand pit was nearly disastrous for that lead for Briggs.
So I see him on the right side of your screen. She hops off both feet in front and then having trouble swinging the leg around. You're in sand, so you're a little bit deeper than you normally would be on the ground relative to the tires and your feet. What you want to do is hop off completely to one side. Keep your handles on the handlebar to make an easier mount once you get out of the sand.
And Briggs leading Norway's Kristen Holta through the Holta contingent there, as you see the waving Norwegian flags, trying to will on Holta from second to first. And that interval is down to 5.5 seconds. It was about 7 seconds one lap ago. And we've seen that Holta is in striking distance if Briggs makes a mistake.
In the third lap, I said before, this is the fifth time they'll be tackling this course. They did it twice yesterday, two times already in the first part of this event. Now it's time to maximize your strengths based off the course. If you're good in and out of turns, go fast on the tight hairpin turns, maybe relax on the straightaways. If you've got power and speed, which Briggs does, she needs to maximize these straightaways to put more distance between her and Holte.
We said during the men's race on this one, you have to take into consideration what they did this morning with 3 miles of running, 500 meters of swimming in between that. The leg burn at this point is just incredible. These Holte and Briggs both love residing in that pain cave, as has been the popular term lately. They love being there, and it shows in events like this.
Well, I think part of that, too, is that it's one thing to be resilient under duress, but it's another knowing how good you are. And that's a confidence thing. If you know you're the best at suffering and you are suffering, they know how that feels to the rest of the field. So that's almost even more motivation to push through that.
Interval decreasing from Briggs to Holte, first to second. It was 5.5 seconds at the start of the lap. We're looking at more like 2.5 seconds at this point, but there have been a couple points on the track where Briggs has relaxed, knowing that she's going to make up time later on.
I don't know if it's relaxing. I think Briggs is in a little too high of a gear for this portion of the bike course. Look how slow her pedals are. Now, she's got the power. I like standing up on the straightaway, but what Holte is doing is this. She's in a lower gear. She's able to start faster out of these turns and straightaways. And so what Sam needs to do is I think she needs to back off the gears, maybe two or three, allow her cadence to kick up, give her legs a break coming in and out of these turns.
The closest we've seen this battle for the lead be on terms of anything other than an obstacle as they approach the barriers for the final time. Holte and Briggs side by side as they get to that first of four walls.
Well, Holte took that inside track on this turn where Sam swung out way too wide, and look how quick Holte goes through. Now she'll start faster because she's in a lower gear. Sam is gonna have to stand up to keep pace with Holte. So these in and outs, this is where Holte is going to get a lead on Sam, even though Sam's gonna pass her right here because she is a stronger, more powerful athlete on this bike. But what Holte's doing is that she's making her work a little harder and a little harder in every single hairpin turn just to either catch up or stay ahead of her. This might add up towards the end, but that is a long straightaway. That is a long time for Sam to use her power and speed at the end. So Holte, I would say now's the time to push the pace when we get to these tight turns on the hill because you are in a lower gear. You take advantage of what you've been good at, and that's these turns and twists and turns on this course.
Briggs looking for her third most all-time 10th career event win. Holte looking for her third career event win, making her fourth appearance at the Games in her own right. She's one of the more underrated athletes when you really look at success at the Games level, especially when it comes to these endurance events. As she's trying to chase down Sam Briggs as they hit the log for the first time of two on this final lap.
Now Holte had taken the lead for just a second out of the turn. Sam Briggs is going way too wide on all of these turns, so she's losing that advantage. And what I said before is that what Holte can do is take the inside, but what she needs to do is keep the inside. Stay aggressive. It's okay to cut someone off. That's part of the sport. This is what this event is supposed to be. Get an inside track, keep the inside track. Force the other athlete to make a move around you.
Briggs third place in event number one, 11th place for Holte in event number one. As they're side by side, it was the inside line for Kristen Holte, and that gives her the line to get around Briggs for the first time in a turn.
And that's what I want to see. Here's one more turn. She's going to get even more of advantage on Briggs right here. And what's going to come out of this? See that low gear standing up? That's what we want to need. Look how slow Sam Briggs' cadence is. She has the power, but that is taking a lot of energy out of her. Holte, go. Gear up, take the turn. You got a straightaway coming. Make Sam chase you now so you can take advantage of that final turn and dismount later.
In day one of the Open this year, it was Holte and Briggs fighting each other in that opening event in Paris on the Open announcement show. They're doing it again here in event number two on the opening day of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games as they approach the sand pit for the final time here on lap number three. Still 3 minutes until the time to beat a 23:06 by Tia Toomey.
Keep your eye on the dismount. Hulte right off and running. Sam Briggs better change it, and she did. Now that's the sign of a veteran athlete, a savvy, smart athlete. Something didn't work. It screwed you up at the end. Get off to the side. What Hulte needs to do is she has no more time to waste. She has a low gear. Sam is going to fall behind about 10 feet right here. And there you see it. She's going to fall back a little bit on this turn as she has been. But what Sam has is the power and the speed. Hulte needs to push the pace right now. It's slightly uphill. You have this last barrier. Take it head on, get around the turn, gear up, and get to the finish.
Looks like Briggs is pedaling a little bit deeper into the turns as well. This is the final obstacle that they'll have, the last log here on this last lap. Holta takes it cleanly, as does Briggs. We've said a couple of times, it's not surprise, but we're a little bit surprised on who's out in front. This one is exactly how we thought it would play out. Hulte and Briggs, one and two, way ahead of anybody else here in this heat.
Hulte, this is the final turn. Now it's downhill. Gear up. Get into the highest gear you can. Stand up and finish. You do not sit on your seat to finish this race. Get up, dance on the pedals, and get yourself a first-place finish.
It's not very often Sam Briggs doesn't take first place in an endurance event, but when it happens, it's usually because of this woman. Kristen Hulte will hold off Sam Briggs by a narrow margin, and she'll take event number two of cyclocross at 21:43, about a minute and a half faster than Tia Toomey's time to beat of 23:06.
And it came from the smart lines on the course, the good turns, the transitions, and saving enough energy. I said before, it's not so much about the speed, but what you're saving during those turns and climbs. And she had enough in the tank to gear up and stay ahead of Briggs.
I don't want to say this is surprising, but I didn't think Katrin David's daughter would be in the third position with some of the names we had in this heat. And the two-time defending champion will round out the top three in the heat and in the event at 22 minutes, 19 seconds.
And it's two things. Know yourself, know the course, and know how you fit within the scheme. And that's what Katrin David's daughter might do better than anybody else out here.
Anna Tobias, one of the better endurance athletes in the sport, will round out the top four at 22:34. This all still under the time of 23:06. Annie Thorisdottir will beat that time as well. So the top five athletes in the heat will be the top five athletes in the event. Tennille Reed-Burline in sixth. And Sarah Sigmund's daughter will be in seventh place in the event for the second consecutive event. Christy Arimo, second place in event number one, will be in the eighth position here in this one in terms of the heat. Now we're starting to have some times from heat number one become a factor in terms of the overall standings. Kristen Pedry making her debut appearance at the games. Coming down the straightaway for the final time. And Valerie Volberl, the oldest American qualifier for the games on the women's side since 2012, be turning 39 during the competition, will finish in the 10th position. And for the final time, it's an opening day of the games for Stacey Tovar. She's making her eighth and final appearance, saying during regionals this was going to be the end of the line for her. Whitney Yalin making her way back after a couple years being unable to qualify for the games. That was also the case for Danny Horan, who actually qualified a couple of years ago, was unable to compete due to an injury prior to the competition. And she's looking very emotional as she makes her way down the straightaway for the final time.
Nah, it just hurts. That's all it is. I think she's fine. She's just working her butt off. And probably the long sleeves and pants is a bad idea. It's going to get hot out there.
So 14th in the heat, 22nd unofficially in the event for Horan. Emily Bridgers making her fourth consecutive appearance at the games. in position to be in the 15th spot. And with those remaining, those are going to be the ones that we're having, for the most part, we're having those issues with the bike. We saw Cassidy Lance McWhorter have issues. Casey Campbell had issues. Carrie Pierce had big issues with the bike where she was running with it to get to the pit area.
Yeah.
Also left, Alexis Johnson and Brooke Wells, as Cassidy Lance McWhorter will finish 16th here in the heat. And this will be Alexis Johnson and Carrie Pierce working for 17th and 18th here in the heat. Pierce will get the pass on Johnson using the inside, hitting that final straightaway, and it looks like, and she qualified well, it looks like it's just going to be that bike issue is what really bit Pierce here in this one.
You know, it's part of the sport. Some people might think that's unfair, but that's the way it goes. If you geared up, geared down too fast, if you hit things too hard, I mean, that's what's going to happen. You got to know how to use your bike as well as be a fit.
You can see the disappointment there for Carrie as she hit 17th in the heat, unofficially 30th in the event. Alexis Johnson 18th in the heat, 31st in the event. And this is what we're speaking about with the big issues that Carrie Pierce had in this event. And she was in the back at some point because of the issues. And we spoke about it. If you got to get the bike to the pit area, you have to carry it yourself there. And so she was running with the bike for about a quarter of a lap.
And what happens is sometimes the chain can pop off and get wedged between the shaft of the pedals and the, you know, spokes or cogs themselves on that, and you almost got to like jam your foot on there to lodge it loose. So when you're in the heat of the moment and things are moving fast, it's really hard to just stop and mess with that for too long.
And looking at the lap times for Pierce, that costly issue with the bike was about a minute 40 there that she lost on that one. The rest of the lap times were right around that 8 minute mark. So Pierce definitely struggling because of that bike issue. Last athlete on the course is Casey Campbell, another one of the athletes that had a significant issue with the bike. It looked like a chain came off going over one of those logs. Still a decent amount of track remains for Campbell. Still well within reason of finishing, though, under the 30-minute time cap that won't take out anybody in the women's field.
Well, it's welcome to the CrossFit Games. This is what happens. You gotta be prepared for this. You know, I'm surprised more bike chains didn't just come off or come loose doing this. And you know, if I were an athlete, I'd practice getting on and off my bike for the obstacles, trying to learn how to put a chain on as fast as possible when it comes up. And those are some of the things you have to prepare for that you wouldn't really think about in sometimes like practice or time trials.
So Campbell will round out the field, 20th in the heat, 39th in the event, but up in front, Kristen Holta, 21:43.23 seconds, about 1.3 seconds faster than Sam Briggs. The top seven here in this event, all in heat number two, including the two-time defending champion Katrin Davidsdottir in third. And what a battle it was between Holta and Briggs throughout this one.
Oh yeah, Holta is actually first out of the gates. You can see her in the blue just off the start, but it was Briggs who was on the bottom right, got the lead early and held onto it for the majority of the time. She was so fast on the straightaway. She had those strong gears. And as they worked back and forth, you know, Briggs hit the sand and she had some dismount issues. So she hops forward and then went over. That worked okay the first time. Later, that ended up biting her on the second lap. And what we saw here is this is where she gets stuck, is that she gets the heel stuck on the dismount, allows Holte to catch up. Holte didn't have to work any harder to end up tied with Briggs right out of the sand trap. And what Briggs is doing is the whole time she had to get caught and then get ahead of her. Get caught, get ahead of her. Get caught, get ahead of her. Holte, look how fast she is through these obstacles. This is where Holte won the race, because Briggs would spend so much energy trying to catch Holte, and what Holte was doing was nothing different. She didn't have to go any faster. She didn't have to work any harder to pass Briggs. She had Holte had great turns, inside lines, coasting on downhills. She was in smaller gear. And what she does is she takes an inside line. She's in a low gear. She's able to stand up and put 10 feet on Briggs. Briggs, who had to stand up in those stronger pedals. Holte took the advantage here. She almost lost it towards the end if you saw her feet slip off the pedals, but it was just enough for Holte to take the win.
Now, you were looking at the back of Sam Briggs for a lot of that race. At what point did you know that was going to change?
I didn't know until I hit the last turns, the downhill and uphills. And I just knew that I had to be really quick on the uphill there to pass her. And then I just had to sprint through the obstacles and all the way to the finish and hope for the best.
What sort of training have you done to make you as comfortable as you were out there?
I haven't done this cyclocross before, but I've done a lot of biking growing up. Been biking in trails and the woods with my dad. I've been challenged with the bike, so I just was familiar with the bike.
You've got a little something written on your hand for inspiration. Let's hold this up. Tell me what it says and what it means.
It says Kriger, it's warrior in Norwegian, and just tells me to never give up.
You were a warrior out there just now. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, she never gave up, and it gave her the win in the end as she got around Sam Briggs to take the heat and event win in event number two. We'll close out event number two with men's heat two action of cyclocross coming up next. One final time, we get some cycle cross action in event number two of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. It's in heat number two in the men's side of the competition. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, Sam Farber with you here at the Alliant Energy Center in Madison, Wisconsin. And they've got to chase down some times. They also got to chase down the man atop the leaderboard, Brent Fikowski, with the event one win and the 100 points that goes with it. Yonakowski, Ben Smith, Bjornfin, Carl Goodmanson, and James Newberry round out the top five in their next task, three laps around this track.
Well, we got 4.5 miles total, 1.5 miles each lap, those tight turns you see, then they're gonna go over the barriers, another turn, some logs, and then the hills. Sand trap in the middle, final set of logs, and they got that nice downhill straightaway to finish and start one lap and to the other.
Here in heat number two, your points leader, Brent Fikowski, will be in lane number seven. Right behind him, a couple of good athletes in terms of the endurance events. Yonakowski will be in lane number six. Jason Smith has shown that he's got that capacity as well in lane three. The fastest qualifier, Ricky Garrard, will be in lane one. Here on the second page, Ben Smith, third place in event number one, very quietly so, will be in lane number 18. But the defending champion, Matt Fraser, will be in lane number two.
Well, I can't wait to see what he comes out and does. I think Michael Jordan said it best, is that I hate losing more than I enjoy winning. And he wants to get back up in that first place position going into this event. And this is a good one for him. He did well in the time trial. Svechowski, phenomenal performance in event number one. Very cerebral, very good pacing. This is another one of those, knowing how to use your gears in and out of the turn. You got to be smart as well as fit for this particular event.
And away we go for the final time with cyclocross. And a bit of a change there, as you saw a little bit of a shakeup in the order. They could pick where they were on that one in the front row, as we saw on the women's side, as they come into turn number one for the first time. And Ricky Garrard will be the leader, the fastest qualifier by 15 seconds over Matt Fraser, will be the leader coming out of turn one.
And that goes with, you know, you build some confidence going in. You know, the guy's a rookie athlete, had a great event one to start off the day, knowing full well that you are, quote unquote, the fastest guy out here based off the time trial times. It's good to get out and then get into your own groove and not worry about the other athletes around you.
So Garrard into the switchbacks for the first time already with about a four-length lead over Fraser in second. I do believe that's Ben Smith in third. Excuse me, take that back. Jason Smith in third. Went with the wrong Smith there. I see the Smith and just went straight to Ben there. Sorry about that.
And I think one thing you see with some of these ex-motocross guys or these flat track athletes is that they know how to read the course. And it doesn't seem like much. It's like, oh, yeah, obviously there's a turn there. I can see that. I don't need to be a cyclist, off-road guy, you know, even a motocross guy. Is that you need to be able to read the turns, not just relative to the people around you, but just understanding that where you can be aggressive or not be aggressive. And that's one of the things we're looking at, is that being aggressive in the right spots, and that's being able to read the field. Not hesitating when making decisions. That's a big one. When do I shift up gears, down gears? Do I push the pace or not? And the gears themselves, it seems silly. We've belabored this for the first three heats, but that is the difference maker on this course, is that knowing how to use the bike that you're on. Because if you do not understand, if you're sitting in a high gear the whole time, you're not going to be able to maximize your performance and your ability on the course.
First time to an obstacle here in heat two of the men's race. Ricky Garrard, he handled it well in the time trials, looks to be handling it well here in the race, but Matt Fraser had the rear wheel of his bike flip that barrier, and it nearly made him drop the bike. He lost a couple of seconds there over that first obstacle.
Well, it's being able to pick the bike up and pick it up high enough to get over those barriers, and I think he grabbed a little too high on that middle cross beam on the bike. You want to pick it up lower, maybe right where the seat spoke meets the frame. And that's a lower position, so it actually allows you to lift the bike higher without having to try any harder.
And on the right side of the screen, it was actually the front wheel that clipped the barrier for Fraser.
Well, look how high his hand is. That is actually, you know, you want to go a little bit lower, like I said, where the seat peg meets the frame. That was a little too high to the handlebars, so that's going to keep the nose of the bike down. You don't have to lift it as high when there's a lower point to grab on the frame. Grab right underneath the seat post, lift the bike up from there.
So Garrard is well out in front. Fraser now under siege by Koski for second, as Koski had the inside line. He will take that position. Jason Smith in fourth, looking to do the same as they approach the log for the first time.
You want to be able to pop the front wheel up, let the back wheel roll over. Make sure you stay over your foot pedals. You do not want to lean forward. A lot of athletes we saw yesterday pulled up the front wheel, stayed too far in front, and then when the back wheel hit the logs, pushed them over the top of the handlebars.
And Ricky Garrard, the rookie out of Australia, and if you're going to describe his sport background in any way, yes, he played professional rugby for a while, but it's more of everything was his background. No surprise that he knows how to handle the bike here. And for more about the bikes, we go down to Sam Farber.
Yeah, these Trek Excalibur 7 bikes, something, as you guys have been saying, that the athletes need to understand. In terms of weight, it's not really a problem for these athletes. It's about 28 pounds, so not anything they should have any difficulty lifting. But as you notice, you got to lift in the right places and get the bike high enough to get over some of the obstacles. Also, this is not your Tour de France style road bike where you can clip in. That's good as you come up to some of these obstacles, but can also be a problem. If you lose your footing anywhere on this course, you can lose a lot of time.
Thanks, Sam. And somebody losing zero time thus far on this opening lap is Ricky Garrard, who looks so comfortable on this first lap.
I like the pace at which he's going, and I like the cadence. And what I mean by that is how fast his feet are revolving onto the pedals. And what you want to see through this entire time is a high cadence. So many different times you see as he hit the sand, and I love how far he got deep into that.
Wow.
That is what I've been waiting to see from a lot of these athletes, is that get into a low gear. You're coming through a downhill. Hit the sand with some speed, especially since it's rain. It's a bit more compact than it was yesterday, so you're not going to squirrel around with the front part of the wheel as much. So stay in a low gear, hit some speed, pedal your way through it, and then buy yourself some time over there on the sand pit.
That's easily the deepest we've seen anybody go into that sand pit. And Matt Fraser back in second place ahead of Yonikoski and Jason Smith. And that playing out a good 10 seconds behind the leader, Garrard.
Now coming off this final obstacle, these logs are a bit higher, more of a pyramid stacked on top of each other. It's straight into enough of a slight incline that if you're in the wrong gear, you're going to have to work a little too hard to get up that.
So Garrard putting the finishing touches on lap number one, but perhaps the most important moment in terms of that fight for second came right here on the right side.
Pedaling through, low gear, pedal, keep the tire straight and then dismount. That's exactly what you want to see a lot of these athletes do, is because you're not going to have to waste time getting off the bike, running through the sand where you can cause you to work a little bit harder than you want to. So I really like to see Matt's how far he went into that sand pit.
Earlier today, we were talking about some of the athletes almost hesitating to throw down some blocks and cut the line a little bit going into the turns. Even on the straightaway, you could see Fraser kind of looking over his shoulder, seeing where everybody was. He's always hyper aware of what's going on around him anyway, but that could be something that helps him out in this close race for second. And the man that Fraser is trying to hold off, Yonikoski, one of the best endurance athletes on the men's field. Fraser in the lighter blue, Koski in that dark blue black shirt, the tank top right behind him.
It seems like he's comfortable just staying on Matt's back wheel, and it's fine. It's this the beginning of the second lap. And what you want to see is that as Ricky Garrard is really starting to extend his lead, we see this a lot in road racing, is that you can work together and help catch him, because there is going to be some drafting, especially in these straightaways. You know, to gear up, turn the speed on, and try to make up some ground, because you don't want to let him. You don't want to let Ricky Garrard get too far ahead, and where it's too much too late by that third lap.
And Koski, I don't think, wanted any part of being in the back half of that draft with Matt Fraser for too much longer, as he goes around him, taking the inside line in one of those switchback turns. And there is a lot of closeness there in the rest of the way through the switchbacks. Down the dirt road for the first time here on the middle of three laps around this 1.5 mile, 20 turn course. It's Garrard 1, Koski 2, Fraser 3, Jason Smith in fourth. He's fallen off that pace from Fraser and Koski just a little bit, but still within striking distance if one of them or both of them slip. And Ricky Garrard with his, I don't even want to call that a misstep. The back wheel hit the barrier, but it didn't really trouble him a whole lot.
I mean, if it's not clean, it's a misstep. You know, you don't have enough time, especially with these athletes chasing you. And Matt did a much better job grabbing a little bit lower on the frame, not letting those front tire clip that barrier.
Fraser and Koski side by side. Looks like Fraser will retake the second position. just bit by bit, that interval from first to that fight for second just continues to increase. Brent Fikowski, the points leader, after lap number one, found himself in 10th in this field of 20. At 6 minutes and 58 seconds for the opening lap, about 40 seconds behind Garrard's first lap of 6:19. Still Koski right on the rear wheel of Matt Fraser as they approach that log. Both clear it smoothly.
You know, Matt looks pretty comfortable on the bike where he is right now. Koski sitting on the rear tire. I personally think that's on purpose because Koski was ahead of him out of the barriers, and it looked like he kind of just let Matt go ahead, which is a pretty savvy move if it's just the two of you guys, because the work that Matt does is going to help Koski if he's close enough to draft on him. You can't really draft on these switchbacks here in the hill, but we have those longer straightaways. It does, and it is an advantage, and you can definitely feel that. But Koski, there's, he got an inside line, so you know what Matt needs to do is tighten up those turns a little bit. I like how he's standing up in between on the uphills, but you got to keep your eyes low on the inside of the turn. You should be looking at those hay bales on the turn. That's going to keep your line true, keep you close enough to the edge, and save some energy and some time in and out of those turns.
And with Koski and Fraser so involved in each other trying to sort out that second and third place, it just allows Garrard to pull away bit by bit as he is well out in front with daylight in front of him.
Here's another one of those straightaways. Koski and Fraser tying up. It looks like he's sitting back a little bit. Maybe let Mac take, pull him through.
It's nice and controlled into the sand pit for Garrard. We'll see if Fraser can recreate what he did the first time. Looks like he's going to go for it. And just like the first time, gets about halfway through.
There's one thing I think Matt's looking for, is that you can see him eyeballing the sand. And here's what you want to do. Find someone else's tire tracks and follow them. Because if you find your own line, there's divots and footprints and chewed up sand everywhere. But if Ricky Garrard just went in front of me, I'm going to follow his tire tracks as follow, because all that is digging a trench for your bike. And now you're not going to hit those divots and turns. So I think that is exactly what Matt's looking for. And I think it's a phenomenal, very savvy move by Matt Fraser.
Fraser and Koski approaching the logs, both over clean. Keep in mind, this is heat two of two. Heat number one was won by Bjørgvin Carl Gudmundsson at 20 minutes, 27.01 seconds, only a half second quicker than Jason Carroll, and a tight finish there. These athletes here in heat number two, led by Ricky Garrard, are trying to chase down that time.
Ricky Garrard, the bottom part of your screen looks so smooth, very relaxed. I like the speed and cadence of his pedal strokes. Seems very comfortable, good breathing. He's in a high gear. It's just a straightaway. It's a little bit downhill. He had about a 10-second edge off Fraser and Koski after the first lap. So I'm curious to see if they've closed the gap.
Ben Smith had a quiet first event, I should say, finishing third place. Here it's a disappointing event for him as he's currently sitting in the 15th position, putting the finishing touches on lap number two.
Going to that final log obstacle. And there's just not a lot of aggression or speed there. I would say it's almost a little too slow. You got to be careful with those log obstacles. You can't take them slow. There's too much jostling when you're popping over there. And if you're too slow, it's going to really dramatically throw your bike off track on those log obstacles. Now, what's cool about these switchbacks, especially if you're the leader, is that you can easily see where the guys are behind you. Instead of having to look over your shoulder, which can be dangerous when you're going at high speeds on these bikes, is that he can just look to the right. There's Matt. I can see him clearly. Matt's actually separated himself quite a bit from Yonikoski. And we're thinking about overall time from lap one to lap two. It seems pretty close at the same time difference between Matt and Garrard after that second lap.
10-second interval after lap number one. It's a 13-second interval after lap number two. So only about 3 seconds lost on that second lap by Fraser to Garrard. But at that point, it's basically barring disaster. This one should be handedly for Ricky Garrard.
But we've seen that happen in the first three heats. All it takes is one slip off the pedal, one bad line out of a turn, and you crash into one of these side barriers. A misstep off the bike into the sand pit. So when you have an opportunity to get some lead, this is where you take it, on the straightaways where there's very little danger when it comes to these obstacles. So on these straightaways, if I'm in the lead, I'm pedaling down, I'm putting my chin down, I'm dancing on those pedals as hard as I can because I know I need to be a little bit more cautious into some of these turns, especially when you're coming up to these barriers.
As Garrard approaches the barriers for the final time here on this third lap, all four walls cleared back on it. He was one position away from making the games 1 year ago, finishing sixth place in the Pacific Regional. Here he gets his first shot at games competition. He's making the most of it as he leads that man, the defending champion, Matt Fraser, by about 13 seconds. Janikowski in third. And these three have really put on, it looks like Koski is struggling compared to Garrard. It looks like Fraser is well behind, but these three are putting on a fantastic performance in this event, especially when you look back how far back everybody else is. So earlier today, we spoke about the rain and how that was going to affect the course. We spoke about how cold it was, but the morning has gone on. We're into the early afternoon here in Wisconsin. For more on the weather, we go to Sam Farber.
Yeah, guys, a lot has changed since we started this event here at Cyclocross. It was about 60 degrees when the day got started, and we obviously had just come off that rain. It's warmed up considerably, up to 70 degrees. I will say this, it's much cooler than it was yesterday, so a little bit more comfortable for the athletes. Fortunately, though, it's been dry. There was some concern after the rain that it might eat up the course quite a bit. The fact that it's been dry has probably helped it hold up for these athletes all throughout the day.
Thanks, Sam. And a very humid day, of course, but that's a lot easier to deal with than rain and almost some thunderstorms around the area, but weren't within striking distance of the course in event number one. As Garrard continuing to lead Fraser, they're first and second, about 13 seconds, continuing to be the interval. Still 3 minutes away from that time from BK Goodmanson in heat number one. And it looks like that will be falling here in heat number two. And no surprise, Garrard was the fastest in the time trials by about 15 seconds over second place Fraser.
Very impressed with Garrard starting at a very aggressive pace, but maintaining that pace throughout this. And look how fast he's coming down that hill. Good tight turn. Leave no doubt. Just make sure you get clean in and out of the turns. You got two more obstacles left to go, so make sure you take advantage of this straightaway.
That is the interval, first to second, just to put in pictures how much of a lead Ricky Garrard has, how impressive he has been throughout this event as he approaches the sand pit for the final time.
What's good is you get to see where Matt is behind him, and he has a very substantial lead. Let's just say be extra cautious getting on and off the bike. You have one more obstacle left to go, and if he just maintains a good steady pace, he's going to be just fine coming into the finish.
Smooth transition off and on to the bike. Matt Fraser making his way to the sand pit. This has been where really he's been the most impressive out of anybody through this obstacle, getting halfway again before he hops off the bike. Logs for the final time for Garrard as Koski makes his way through the sand pit.
You know, Matt Fraser really tried to push the pace here on this third lap, but Garrard is just not backing down. In fact, he's speeding up coming into this final stretch.
And through this downhill sweeping left for the final time, Still a minute 15 seconds. He could basically fall off the bike and walk it the rest of the way and have this event win in impressive fashion. The second career event at the Games for Ricky Garrard. It's his first career event win in very impressive fashion. 1 minute ahead of the former time to beat.
Wow, what more can you say other than just what an incredible start to him? You know, you want to see if they have the rookie nerves when you come in, a lot of adrenaline, but just to keep focus, making sure you play your game, and it paid off. Ricky Garrard, under 20 minutes.
Oh, by the way, second place for Matt Fraser, and the reigning and defending fittest man on earth is in a great position after the morning here on the opening day.
And in a great event in the morning, and cap it off with a second place finish in this event in total. It's going to set him up nice for this afternoon.
Also a good morning today on the first day of competition for Yonikoski. Second in event number one, third in event number two. Jason Smith. It took him a while, took him 7 years of trying, six of those with top 10 finishes at a regional, and he's finally made it to be the first native African competitor to qualify for the games. He will be in fourth, and this is the race here. Cody Mooney leading the way for fifth. Four athletes making the way through. It is Mooney in fifth, Esslinger in sixth, Alex Anderson in seventh, and Samuel Quant in eighth. Points leader coming into this event, Brent Fikowski trying to hold off fellow Canadian Patrick Vellner. They surrounded third and fourth at the games last year. It will be Fikowski taking the position. He's in ninth, Vellner in 10th. That's Street Horner, rookie from the Central Regional, in 11th. George Sanchez, rookie out of the West Regional, will be our 12th finisher, and the veteran of the U.S. Army will round out the top 15 unofficially in this event. James Newbury, the Pacific Regional champion, 13th here in the event. We're starting to see some more of those times from heat number one become a factor. Looks like he'll be 17th in the event. Elijah Muhammad making his way down that downhill turn onto the straightaway for the final time. So it'll be Muhammad in 14th here in the heat. Give 15th place to Holden Rethwill. Zach Carchetti in 16th. And the rest of the field making their way through. Logan Collins in 17th, Dakota Rager in 18th, and the 2015 champion Ben Smith 19th in the heat, 28th unofficially in the event. And Mitchell Cinnamon will be the last athlete remaining on the course.
You know, Ben can be a slow starter and a strong finisher. He did it at regionals in years past. He did it this year, too. I'm not worried about Ben. I think, you know, the question remains is, you know, biking maybe not a Smith brother forte. It could be that. But I'm not worried about Ben Smith. We'll just throw that out there.
And if you want to know how hard this event is, you got a good visual representation of it at the look of the face of Mitchell Cinnamon, who is struggling through this final half of a lap. And this is no easy task, despite what Ricky Garrard made it look like about 3 minutes ago when he completed this.
And that's what I'm saying is, like, these athletes are so good across the board. It doesn't really matter what you throw at them. And then you see, you know, a more human element come into play with an event like this. And, you know, you have Mitchell finishing up, but the good thing is I believe people might have an opportunity to do this later just to really see how hard this could be for a, we'll say, a normal human being.
So the 27-year-old making his second consecutive appearance at the Games out of South Melbourne, Victoria, Australia. Still about 6.5 minutes until that half hour time cap, so well in position to beat that. So he makes his way through that left turn for the final time down the straightaway, and he's gonna be welcomed by at least 1,000 fans who have made their way to the dog park to watch the cyclocross event. And Mitchell Cinnamon will round out the field here in heat number two on the men's side of competition in event number two as he comes across the line. 20th place in the heat in at 24-14. It'll be good unofficially for 38th in the event. So your top four in the event results all coming from heat number two. No surprise there. They were all in the top five in the qualifying times, led by the pole sitter, the top qualifier after the time trials yesterday, and the event winner by nearly 30 seconds, Ricky Garrard at 19:26.
Ricky Garrard was out to a great start. Led early, led in the middle, and it never looked back as he was well ahead already going into the first obstacle. Fraser, a little low at the catch, almost took himself out on that first one. That'll be the last time you see Fraser struggle on this course, although relative to Garrard, just so far behind. But watch Fraser, eyes down, find the tire track and ride it as far as you can through the middle, low gear, fast pedals. He did that three times in a row. Those transitions were good. Garrard, this is him all by himself over the barriers. Fraser just in the back part of your screen. And this was a scene to unfold as Garrard coming through just annihilated the top time set in the previous heat. And having a rookie debut, no better way to finish off a second event than with a dominating win for Ricky Garrard.
Ricky, an outstanding performance here today on the bike. Obviously comfortable on two wheels. What in your background gave you the experience to perform so well here today?
So I grew up on a farm in Australia, and I used to ride to school most days. And if I caught the bus, I'd catch a bus home, get on the bike, and just go for a ride every afternoon, hit the trails, hit the jumps, just being a kid.
So the lesson to the kids watching at home is ride your bike to school. You might win a CrossFit Games event.
Yeah.
For you, this is something you've dreamed about for a long time. You just missed the CrossFit Games a year ago. How much motivation did you have coming into regionals this year and, of course, the games?
Yeah, my motivation's through the roof. I missed out by 2 points last year, and I think that's the best thing that's ever happened to me. I've been hungry since, and I've been dreaming of this moment for a long time now, and I'm just stoked to be here, and I'm just, yeah, speechless.
Ricky, congratulations.
Yeah, thank you. Cheers.
Well, if day one is any indication, Ricky Garrard getting to the games, he's here to stay as he had a strong showing, including the event to win. And we haven't seen bikes at the games since 2012. We saw a lot with this one, and we'll have the remainder of day number one coming up later today.
clear compound. Next thing I know, I stepped on an IED. My anger brought me into the box. It was therapeutic for me. I saw the community coming together, cheering you on, the camaraderie. It felt like, you know, being back with the unit. I needed to give back. So I figured, what if I just show people what I do? You know, try to motivate them in my own way. I had a goal to run the Boston Marathon. Running with the flag, it was in honor of my brothers that I served with in Afghanistan. I wanted to show them, hey, we're still fighting. Through tragedy comes great strength.
Every year the crowd sort of picks its favorite. I think this man is in the running.
The individuals are through two events, teams are through one. Welcome back, everybody, back inside the beer garden here at the Alliant Energy Center, the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. Tommy Marquez alongside 80 inches combined of bicep between Dan Bailey and Brooke Entz here. Guys, we just saw individual event two go down, the cyclocross, starting with the women. We saw a pretty impressive performance between some women who had some serious capacity.
A lot of capacity. I mean, there was three rounds, and those women getting through the first round could really iron out the bumps, right? Really get more comfortable with the transitions, and then it's all about capacity. And that really showed with Sam Briggs and with Kristen Holtze right off the bat, showing that their legs and their upper body could handle that and maintain pace
and
for a long period of time.
Yeah, and early on, Sam Briggs and Kristen Holtze established themselves as the leader. Briggs would actually take the early lead, kind of charging to the front there. But over the course of the race, we saw Kristen Holtze, who was the leader coming out of the time trial, start to catch Sam Briggs slowly. We see the transitions here on the sand becoming key. Athletes would try to motor halfway through before finishing the rest of the way on foot. And Holtze would pass Sam Briggs eventually after one or two laps in, and then we start to see endurance.
It's showing you being adaptable, learning from your first round and getting better every time, being smart.
Holtze made a move on the boards, and she would basically fight off Sam Briggs the rest of the way. It would be a nice battle between the two, but ultimately Holtze holding the inside line here would walk away with the event win. She was your top person out of the time trial, and she would take the event win in number two, the cyclocross. Here are your event standings for the women. Kristen Holtze was in first, Sam Briggs was in second, two-time reigning champ Katrin Davis' daughter in third, followed by Anna Tobias, Annie Thor's daughter. We saw event one winner Tia Claire Toomey, who won her heat, would finish eighth overall, followed by Bethany Branham and Christy Arimo. And then here are your overall standings after two events for the women. Sam Briggs, she is just a machine. She leads Tia Claire Toomey by 14 points, who sits in second. Holtze Arimo, who did great in both events, followed by Tennille Reed Berline, Sarah Sigmund's daughter, and Katrin Davis' daughter in sixth and eighth, respectively. Pretty strong performance so far between some of these women. We're saying some of the same names over and over. But for the men, Dan, I know on the men's side of things, we saw some shakeups here with Brent Murkowski. But for this bike event, we saw a couple of new names pop up to the front.
Yeah, I mean, the two guys who had the best time trials, Ricky Gard and Matt Frazier, ended up being the top two in the event. And that was really no surprise. Ricky Gerard has skills in a multitude of sports, one of them being motocross. He's very familiar on two wheels. Same thing with Frazier. He's been on a motorcycle all his life. The guy knows how to handle it.
It's almost like the time trials matter, right? The top two guys coming out of the time trials were the top two early on. We saw a stumble from Matt Frazier going over the board. But you know what? Cool, calm, collected, didn't bother him. Ricky, on the other hand, just consistently built a lead. Every little transition, every little obstacle just looked smooth to him.
I think that's part of a skill subtlety for this event for some of the guys, displaying that coordination, the agility, the balance, the accuracy, and every turn and every hurdle, every time you're in the sand pit, all that's going to add up over the course of three laps.
Ricky Gerard is a rookie at the CrossFit Games, but he did not look like one here in this event. Gerard, coming out of Australia, would win his very first event of his CrossFit Games career. You could tell he was pumped. He controlled it pretty much wire to wire. Brooke, I think I see your husband in our shot there.
Always getting
the
in the way,
footage,
you know?
Of course, of Ricky Gerard, an impressive performance from him. And here are your standings in the event. Gerard first overall, followed by the reigning champ, Matt Frazier. Jonikoski, a strong performance in both events. He finishes third. Jason Smith, the athlete from South Africa finishing in fourth. We see Frederick Ogidius from Heat 1, Cody Mooney, Lucas Esslinger, strong performances as well. Here are your overall standings after two events for the men. Yonikoski sits in first place overall with 182 points. Fraser in second, but well within striking distance. Brent Fikowski won the first event. He's in fourth. Ricky Garrard moves himself up into fourth with an event win in event number two. And we are joined now by the CrossFit subject matter expert, the aerobic capacity seminar, Chris Hinshaw. He's basically the guy you need to talk to when you want to get better at aerobic capacity. Chris, thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you very much for letting me be here.
So we had two very different events today, but two very important events. Tell me a little bit about how these events play into the test overall and some of the keys to these.
Well, I love how these two events kicked off the CrossFit Games. Clearly, they're both endurance events and they're testing the aerobic fitness of the athletes. I love the time domains. I mean, that run, swim, run, very well balanced. For the good athletes, it was taking them roughly 8 minutes to do the run, 8 minutes to do the swim, and then 8 minutes to do the run. In the endurance world, that relationship was very important, very well programmed. I also love the fact, outdoor events, right? Both of them. Most of us work out inside, and for those two events starting off the games to make athletes test fitness outdoors, amazing, really, for me.
And talk about the time frame, because they didn't have much time to recover here. How much does that factor into the performances here?
So I'm a huge fan. I'm a huge fan of how Dave Castro writes out workouts, and there's a lot of hidden workouts within the workouts, and you pointed out a very good thing. The fact is that he pushed these athletes in a very long time domain and then didn't give them enough rest to fully recover and then put them into something that required balance, agility, stability, and also aerobic capacity. 1 hour of rest, minimal.
Awesome. Yeah.
One thing that I noticed, and I think a lot of people may have noticed too, watching the final kick with Tia and with Christy, you saw the stride difference, yeah. Right? So I learn and I run where I think more contact with the floor, and you saw that with Tia Clear to me, yeah. And you saw bigger strides on the other side. What would you recommend maybe in that position? Do you think it's more of their background or is it just them playing their own game?
So I know from Tia's programming and her training, she has spent a tremendous amount of time with her closing speed. She will never get beat in the last 30 seconds ever again. She spent a lot of time in what we call her speed reserve. Her maximum speed compared to her cruising speed. And that last segment she has prepared all year for. And so when it came down to it, it was almost a game to her.
Oh, it was awesome.
Yeah, it was really spectacular. And it shows an athlete that's fully in control. These events, for her, I mean, she walked out really shining.
What can you tell me, Chris, about, we talked a little bit about recovery within the event. What can you tell me about now leading into tonight and also tomorrow? Like, if they haven't been prepping with run, swim, run, obviously the bike's going to throw them off a little bit. If you haven't been training for these things, building your aerobic capacity, what's that going to do to you for the rest of the weekend?
Yeah, I mean, I think that there's two things. We've got the physical side and the recovery physically. And if you're not aerobically fit, let's face it, aerobic fitness is all about recovery. The more aerobically fit athlete is going to recover faster than anybody else. And so when they did all of their training, they recognized that that's a strength. If you haven't, that amount of damage mentally, knowing that you've got to come back and recover, is going to be the challenge for them. There's going to be a lot of negative self-talk that they're going to battle with. And those athletes that did the homework, that they truly worked on their outdoor skills, they're the ones that are going to rest easy tonight.
And they're just not worried.
Yeah, you work with a ton of these athletes. Are you surprised by any of the performances here? Are there any things that factored into this workout that maybe you didn't think about or anything that surprised you in particular?
Not really, no. I like that the fact that they tested these as different events. Mm-hmm. That there are people that are skilled in doing a run, swim, run in those relationships, but they don't have the agility and the stability to manage a course like that out there. That was not a bike path. That, with the rain that came down this morning, changed the environment completely. And maybe on TV, but if it looked like it was much easier, but watching it and what the athletes had to do in controlling the bike and the slickness of the turns and the mud, it was a completely different element.
In terms of physical output too, for some people at home that might be watching, they look at the time domains, they think they're pretty similar. They think you're just kind of putting your head down and trudging. What are the differences and the difference in nuances between these two events in terms of what these athletes kind of have to effort by going out there and performing?
So that's the thing, is every single movement you do is unique, mm-hmm. and every speed within that movement is unique. And so if you think that you're going to train for a 5K and then it turns out to be a 400-meter run, you're not prepared. And so that's what the trick is with CrossFit, is you don't know the time domains. And when we look at this time domain in the run, 30 minutes, and then you look at these athletes that finish the bike ride in 20, it's apples and oranges. One's a swim and a run, and the other is a bike. 30 minutes and 20 minutes is completely different. You ask anybody in the endurance world, you're gonna train for a 30-minute event, does that prepare you for a 20-minute event? And they're totally different animals.
So if we have this competition that's going on, it's called the Fittest Fan, and some of the fans will get to take on this run.
I actually entered.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Can't wait.
That's not fair.
Oh, no.
I'm going full speedo.
You've got an Ironman triathlete here. That is not a fair race.
Full speedo. But full on speedo.
If we're talking to the general population, the people at home that are watching, that are tuning in, that are maybe going to take this on, maybe what's, and this may be a little bit too much, but what's something maybe they could focus on for this workout that you would recommend that might just help them a little bit in this type of workout?
So personally for me, I really feel that they should enjoy this experience. I mean, here we are with the CrossFit Games, and what we want to do is we want to take away some pleasantries, right? I mean, the environment outside is overwhelming. I mean, this venue in comparison to Carson, it's mind-boggling how good it is. And when they go out and they do that event, enjoying something. Workouts are all about learning, right? Yeah. And I think that what they need to do is have some solid takeaways. For me, I love that transition of when they exited and from the run into the swim, and then they got out of the water, and from the swim into the run. That experience, if you've never done that, mm-hmm. and watching how fast the elites did. I mean, these guys were putting on their shoes and taking off their shoes in 3 seconds. Measure your fitness and how fast you could get your shoes on against the best of the best.
There was a lot of running in this event, and something we talked about previously a little bit, about how you can tell the difference in swimmers when we're in the water. We saw the differences when it played out. What was one thing that you could kind of keep your eye on, you can tell right away, like, that person is in trouble when they're in the water?
So, I mean, I always look at head height and how high, and you guys really brought that up well, the head height. But I look at it in terms of how aggressive they are in coming into the transition. If they are backing off on their pace, there is a lot of panic and concern on their part. And you saw athletes that were strong swimmers attack that transition and then attack the water. The way that entry point was in the water with the carpet, the waters, there's no chill, there's no waves, and so there should be no apprehension. The great swimmers, they attacked. I mean, not that Rich Froning is world class by any means in his swimming, but that leg, they went from 11th to out of the water in third.
Wow.
Really mind-boggling because they attacked.
Well, Chris, thank you so much joining us. I really appreciate you taking the time. He's a subject matter expert for CrossFit and the Aerobic Capacity Seminar. Where can we find your stuff online? Instagram, Facebook?
Aerobiccapacity.com. It's all there. We've got a bunch of seminars that are coming up with CrossFit. I think we've got 13 posted around the world. We're going to Europe and down in Brazil. And, yeah, that's been incredible for me. I'm beyond grateful to be able to share, you know, what I'm able to pick up in the sport and for CrossFit giving me that window.
And if you haven't taken the Aerobic Capacity Seminar, I have been to a few, and it's just a whole different way to look at endurance. And it gives you numbers, it gives you science, it gives you so much more to work on. It's incredible. It's so much more than just going for a run, you know?
Thank you very much.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
Yeah, no, it's a good experience, and I'm very grateful that CrossFit gave me that chance.
Well, thank you, Chris. We're going to take a quick break. We're going to send you guys now to the Expo Center. Dave Castro has got an announcement coming for some of the individual competitors.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Did you guys enjoy the first two events? It was a long morning. It was exciting. We did a nice little run, swim, run into the cyclocross course. How did that turn out? What did you guys think of that? We learned a lot from that. I have some ideas. It'll be better if we ever do it again. But you guys did great. That was a cool course, so really happy with how that went down. Teams, did you guys enjoy the run, swim, run? Who won? Good job. Where are you guys out of? UK? You guys swim out there? You ready for shit to get real? All right, here we go. The 2007, the first CrossFit Games, the first workout. Does anybody remember what that one was? Cammy, you want to take a shot? Was it row 1,000? It was also the 2007 Chipper. What was that event? 1K row, pull-ups, and shouldered overhead. That was the first event we ever did in Aromas. 2008, 2009, those 3 years were hosted in Aromas. 2010, that year, we were still planning on hosting the games there, but we had to find a new venue, and we eventually held them in Carson. Does anyone remember the first event we held in Carson? Amanda. Amanda, Amanda, Amanda. 9.75, muscle up, squat snatch at 135. What's gonna be the first workout we do inside the Coliseum in Madison? Isabel, I just kind of give you this amazing lead in. I just built it all up. Amanda, you all are doing Amanda tonight. The individual athletes are doing Amanda. From 2010 to 2017, the capabilities, the abilities of you guys has increased by a lot. What do you typically do now when Amanda comes up? As an athlete, when Amanda comes up, what do you typically do? Go heavy. You guys all go heavy. You guys all go heavy. We're not gonna go heavy. We are not gonna go heavy with Amanda. How about we go the opposite direction? 9.75, but why don't we start with 11.975? And how about we take it a step further? 13. What if we do Amanda at the standard prescribed original 2010 weight, but we add a round of 13, add a round of 11, then you get into the standard Amanda, 9.75. That is your event for the individuals tonight. You are going to do 13 muscle-ups. 13 squat snatches, 135, 95. 11, 11, 9, 9, 7, 7, 5, 5, cross the finish line. The rig in the Coliseum will be set up with five different rigs. The Coliseum will be set up with five different rigs, and you'll race through. It'll be continual effort straight through. Any questions? Are you guys excited about that one? Because we sure are. Teams, let's talk about you guys. You guys are not going to do Amanda. You guys are going to do a variant of it. We're going to do muscle-ups and squat snatches. Here's what's going to happen with you guys. You guys are all going to take the field of play, all six athletes, and then the three men will go first. And you guys will complete 30 muscle-ups as a trio, 30 squat snatches. 24, 24, 18, 18, 12, 12, 6, 6. That's one event. There'll be a time cap, or you guys will finish it before the time cap. There'll be a one-minute transition. Then the women will do the same thing, but you guys will all have been on the floor at the same time. And then you got the female reps are different. whereas the men were 30, 24, 18, 12, 6. The women, your rep scheme is 27, 21, 15, 9, 3. One person working at a time, rotating through each segment. Any questions? This is how we're going to welcome the CrossFit Games to Madison with a true classic CrossFit event tonight. So let's get excited, because this one, there's going to be some fireworks for this one. Teams, I think you guys are getting briefed first, because you have to go before the individuals.
Three questions.
Such an individualized thing.
All right, guys, so Dave Castro just dropped an announcement on us for both the individuals and the teams as well. Just to get you guys caught up and kind of sort through all of that, the teams and individuals will be doing a variation of Amanda. The teams, they'll split it into trios, three men and three women. The men will do 30, 24, 18, 12, 6 of squat, snatches, and muscle-ups. The women will do 27, 21, 15, 9, and 3. And then you heard the individuals just before that as well. They'll be doing Amanda 45, but a little bit of a twist. They beefed it up a little bit more. They added more reps. They added a round of 13 and 11 ahead of what is normally a 9.75. So it goes 13, 11, 9.75 reps, four times of muscle-ups and squat snatches. Now, guys, Amanda was the very first event that took place at our old home at the StubHub Center in LA. This is a much different workout. How does adding these reps really change the stimulus here?
I mean, you're doubling Amanda, basically, you know, and not in like a 975, 975 kind of way. You've got to be smart. These athletes need to be realistic with what their ability is with both of these movements, and you know, don't go out too hot. You know, I would definitely be breaking mine up very early, and then my goal would be to probably try and go 9.75 unbroken at the end and really kind of save that for the end.
I think it's similar to the end of the 2015 games. Dave said, hey, we're going to do Grace. By the way, it's double. Like, so everybody's ears perk up when they hear a name workout, and then, oh, but we're going to change just one little thing. So most men, I feel like the top men are all going to be, would be sub three, right around 3 minutes for an Amanda time. That's going to be a competitive CrossFit Games time for that. Now you're throwing in basically doubling the workout, like we mentioned. You're going to have to be really careful with how you approach this. I'm imagining we're going to see a lot of just drop from the top snatches. You're going to break up those muscle-ups into some kind of interval work-rest ratio that works for you, and then hammer down on that 7 and 5.
But, and think about, too, what they just did on the bike. That upper body on not a road, like that terrain, this jolting, it's going to play in favor for someone like Ricky Gerard, who comes from a motocross background, having that capacity in your upper body, being able to clear fatigue, you know, throughout the workout. Grip is going to be an issue.
Certainly going to be a fun event to watch to kick off things in the Coliseum. Amanda is a named workout. It's named after Amanda Miller, who was a CrossFit Games athlete in 2009 and unfortunately passed away. Now, we do named workouts all the time, but talk to me a little bit, for some of the people who weren't around in 2010 when this workout came out, the significance of the named workouts and why it's important to have things like this, these memorial workouts, and retest them.
Yeah, I mean, anytime there's any kind of workout that's in memory, it just adds another element to the workout itself. So
let's,
everybody's already completely competing against each other. You've got everybody racing in the other lanes. But now when things get difficult and you start to second guess yourself, you have that person in the back of your mind. Hey, this is for somebody who either paid the ultimate sacrifice for a lot of workouts or who's a big fan in CrossFit and happened to pass away. I can push that extra inch for them.
Well, it's certainly nice to be able to see these athletes push for Amanda Miller in a new variation of what is a classic CrossFit workout now. But that's going to be taking place a little bit later on this afternoon. We're going to get you guys caught up on the competition schedule for the rest of the day. 1:30 p.m., the teenagers take on the run, swim, run event. That's in the Boulevard. 1:55, the team muscle-up snatch event we just heard announced inside the Coliseum. 3 p.m., the masters, male and female, they will do the one rep max snatch. That's for the age group pavilion, where that will be taking place. Then at 4:15, and then 5:45, individuals will be taking on Amanda 45. Spectator fan experience for today, 2 p.m., Zevia Beverage Company will be doing a presentation. Then at 3, CrossFit conjugate methods will be presented in the fan experience area. Then at 4, the Buddy Lee jump rope demonstration. And of course, you guys have been involved in the conversation thus far via social media, and our very own Brooke Entz has been paying attention to all of that. Brooke, what do you got for us? What's been happening on the interwebs?
A lot has been happening, seeing people watching from their couch, watching from work, and then watching from outside here, which is really cool for us because we are stuck indoors, which it was raining, so it wasn't a terrible place to be. But something we've got Nico super excited to take a photo with Rich Froning. I know I've been in that place where it's really cool to meet an athlete that you look up to. That is adorable. Jet, the snatch master, comes to class today to learn and practice. And no breaks. Hashtag bathroom, not a bathroom break. This guy is so committed to watching the CrossFit Games, he's taking that laptop everywhere. Been there, done that.
Gonna get you guys caught up on the weather situation here in Madison, Wisconsin. The temperature is 71 degrees, 83% humidity with a little bit of mild wind. As you can see behind me, there's been a weather advisory. People are being advised to seek shelter indoor for the time being. You can see here on the Doppler a little bit of green blob right there going over our red dot. That represents Madison, where we are at. So a little bit of a storm passing through. But that's going to be it for us right now at the desk. We'll be coming live to you guys in just a moment after the teams take on event number 2 and 3. That's the Muscle Up Snatch Workout.